2 minutes past the hour. We'll open the Board of Selectmen meeting. What's our date today? September 6, 2016. Meeting is being brought to us live by RCTV, as well being recorded by them. And on the agenda tonight, we have Selectmen's liaison reports and comments. We'll have a time for public comment as well. We'll have the town manager's report. We're going to have a very festive evening to start off with the fire department's pinnings ceremony, which should be fun. We have a committee member to discuss. We're going to be continuing the hearing, the transfer of liquor license from Brooks Brew and Fine Wine, 676 Main Street, to Anastasi Brookline, 25 Walker's Brook Drive. We'll have Chipotle in for request of a liquor policy waiver. We have Train Depot roof repairs down on 32 Lincoln Street to discuss the roof repairs going on there. We have drainage abandonment of an easement, 21 Hunt Street and 26 Lee Street. We'll be closing the warrant for the October 18th, 2016 special election. We'll also be having a preview of the warrant for November for a subsequent town meeting. We'll then discuss fiscal year 17 goals and Reading 2020 updates. We'll also have a discussion on the town manager performance evaluation process. And we will be concluding the evening with an approval of amplified sound permit for flag football. All right, so with that in mind, I'll start on my left with Selectmen's liaison reports, Dan.
Thank you, Kevin. Yeah, most of my activities have been surrounding the financial forums and other items attending the upcoming override. There was a September 1st financial forum that was fairly well attended, about 100 people, looked like about a town meeting size group, maybe a little bit smaller. A lot of new faces I hadn't seen, so that was encouraging. It was televised, and the video is up on YouTube on the RCTV site. I would encourage anyone who would like a lot of good information about the override to go to the RCTV website, look at the links, and you will find that broadcast. I also, Al, I see you're here tonight. I think the Chronicle may have conveyed a little bit of misinformation about the rate of increase for the override. I believe it said it was 14% plus 2.5. The 14% includes the 2.5.
I meant the 2.5.
Going forward? Forward? Okay, that wasn't clear then. Then you're correct, yeah. I just wanted that to be on the record. Please do take a look at that meeting if you weren't able to participate or join it and view it.
All right, thanks. Bear?
No liaison reports per se, but would like to plug a personal thing. Many of us work with that great organization in town, Understanding Disabilities. Mm-hmm. On the town fair, I will be in jail.
Jail and bail.
So encourage everybody to come down and make a donation to get me out of jail. Or as my son would say, can I make a donation to get you in jail? So
you can arbitrage it.
Yeah, we can do both. So I'll be down there in pinstripes.
All right.
So come on down and support that great organization.
I'll be there with bells on.
I'll be there in chains.
Excellent. John?
I had the pleasure of awarding Tessa Senders the proclamation we signed 2 weeks ago for
the right.
Girl Scout Gold
yep.
Award.
Glad you could make it.
My daughter was a Girl Scout. At the time, I didn't have the pleasure to visit Camp Rice Moody, but what a lovely facility and a lovely ceremony. A great family, Joanne. You've raised a great daughter, you and your husband. So she demonstrated the concept, this robot or device that monitors the level of sound, and accolades from all around, including proclamations from the state level as well, some of our representatives. It was a great evening, so I appreciated the opportunity.
Excellent, that's great. As well as Dan, I attended the last financial forum, so I thought it was a good turnout. I think the number around 120 that was reported was pretty accurate, seemed to be. I didn't take a head count, but seemed to certainly be a good turnout. There were folks, you know, looking for, you know, to give comment and questions on, you know, for both that are pro and probably against the override. But in general, I thought it was a good presentation put on by the town manager and Dr. Doherty as well on the school side, and some good discussion points that came up during that as well. So. I think that was a good night. I we'll say the same thing at the end, that please folks, if you haven't had a chance to and you're interested in seeing that, that is on RCTV, that you can view that with. As of right now, I don't have anything else to comment on, so I will open it up to a room for public comment. Yes, if you just wouldn't mind saying your name and address for...
Yes, sure. I'm Will Finch. I'm a Mill Street resident and former Conservation Commission member. And also, there's also some folks here from the Historical Commission as well as the Trails Committee. You may have probably, there was a letter in your packet concerning some activities up on Mill Street, working on a bridge up there. I think that I'm just here to just encourage better communication between staff in Town Hall and the various commissions that have interests in that area. I think it may have started with the North Reading Conservation Commission and our engineering department that really didn't follow the procedure that we would normally follow here. The kind of work they were doing on that bridge would have required a notice of intent filing, which requires notifying all abutters in the area, which would have included the town of Reading since we own property there. In this case, it was deemed to be a, I believe, an RDA, which doesn't require...
What's an RDA mean?
resource delineation.
That's two out of three. That's great.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they, as I say, normally the kind of work they were doing in the stream bed on the bank would require a notice of intent filing. Anyways, this are actually what they brought to Town Hall. Mike Sorrigan was the town engineer, brought to our Town Hall a legal notice which stating that they intended on doing work on the bridge. And at that point, the communication seems to have ended. So Conservation Commission wasn't notified, and Historical Commission wasn't notified. And so we didn't realize anything was planned until we saw construction vehicles on site and some work being done. So I just, you know, there's a lot of blame to go around, but I do encourage Reading to definitely keep track of what's going on up there and give them the proper committee's notice. And this happened when the MWRA project was getting started, where they wanted to run a pipe underneath the river to connect Reading and North Reading.
I remember that, yeah.
And there was a delineation done, and again, this was instigated by North Reading. Some folks in Reading knew about it. I believe George Zamboros of the engineering department knew about it. But by the time we found about it, his statement was, well, it's a done deal. They're going to put a pumping station down by the river. And so the various groups, Conservation, Historical Commission, had to kind of do catch up to figure out what was going on and to lend our voice to the situation. So I just ask that you improve communication, especially when it's in a sensitive area like this.
And then is that bridge, just to, Will, to get me back up to speed on, I know the bridge from traveling over it, see plenty of conservation area in and around it.
Mm-hmm.
The bridge itself, is it a historic bridge that we have in town, the older ones we have, right?
Yes, it's an historic bridge. It's part of an old mill complex that was there starting in the 1700s.
Okay.
And I don't dispute the fact that the bridge needs work. In fact, I talked personally to both the town engineers, North Reading and Reading, pointing out some blocks that were shifting, and so I don't dispute that. And in fact, the work maybe could have done under an emergency order, but in any case, we are where we are now. But they believe they've finished the work on the bridge, although I'd be happy to. I'd like to have an engineer pass muster on the work that they did.
But just from a communication standpoint, to at least have the get the heads up.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Jonathan Barnes. I'm here as well from on the same subject matter. I'm here primarily on behalf of the Historical Commission. I'm a member. I'm also here as a private citizen to express the same comments. That bridge, in answer to your question, and I think I've addressed this before, and I have provided some correspondence to the Selectmen as well and to the town. As you all know this, it's prominently displayed on the right in front of you,
on the
town seal. Yes, that is a significant historical structure and site, as I think I've mentioned previously. It goes back to the 1600s and is on the Massachusetts Historical Commission inventory as a historic archaeological site of the Commonwealth and certainly of the town. That site emanates, its focus is obviously the mill is in the river area, but that bridge is essentially the focus of that archaeological site, which then goes out, I believe, 100 feet radius around that area. But the bridge itself is comprised of the granite foundation of that bridge. The underpinnings of that bridge are the granite foundation of the Lobster Pound Mill and its sluiceways, and it is of enormous significance to the town and to the Commonwealth. And as I think I've referenced previously, as a result of the North Reading project, or the North Reading project with Reading regarding the water supply system, that site is currently a part of the review process by Massachusetts law. Because it is an archaeological site, the Massachusetts Historical Commission, as well as the Reading Historical Commission, by law are required to be involved in the dialogue concerning the process, and I know that they have agreed most significantly and importantly to locate the water pump station, which was going to be on site there somewhere elsewhere and off of the archaeological site. But there still is the enormously important impact of the water supply, the water connection and the water supply. And I don't know whether anything additional has happened since we last talked about it. I think I attended your meeting in May. At the time, the North Reading representatives were here to speak with you about that. And I don't know whether anything more has happened about that project, by the way, other than the fact that they've heard from the Mass Historical Commission about the obligation to have them participate in the discussion to mitigate the adverse impacts along with us. I do know this much, that we have not been advised of any other activity, and we don't frankly know whether there have been any further discussions about the location of that water main connection or the location of the water supply, whether it's going to go over the bridge, under the bridge, as we've all strenuously advocated, or elsewhere on the site. And if there have, I asked previously that we be involved in that process and the discussion about that process, and I want to piggyback onto the conversation about the need for greater communication. I do know that there was an email that Bob was kind enough to share with us that the town received from North Reading, I think the week before this particular project was started. And I'm happy to note, or I did happily note in that email, that North Reading did indicate that they were aware of the concern of the Reading Historical Commission about any adverse impacts to that site. But unfortunately, and that's why they were, at least that's why they asserted, they were communicating in advance. But regrettably, as you now know, we were never notified after that of what that work was or wasn't. And I just want to reiterate, I can't speak to what actually happened at that site, and I understand there was an emergency, it was of an emergency nature, and I understand that the Conservation Commission is now aware. And I also understand from some of the photographs that the work was very sensitively done. And I also know that it's going to be the subject of a discussion at the Conservation Commission, I believe, later in September. But I want to, as strenuously as I can, ask that you inform us and the Conservation Commission, and ask that you ask North Reading to inform us and have us involved in any of the processes that involve work on that very important historic structure.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yes, Dan.
I could just add, John, that their town meeting did approve initial design phase funding. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
Okay, so I would expect no serious construction. They might possibly be doing borings and that kind of thing. You know more? Okay, Virginia.
Virginia Adams, member of the Historical Commission. I have a number of photographs if you have any interest in them. Because what they did was start working on the bridge abutments on the northern side. And their equipment was huge that they were using.
You talking about the bridge repair or the MWRA?
No, about the bridge repair.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the actual project that's gonna put the water main through and build the pump station. These were emergency repairs to the bridge. This is a separate issue from what I'm talking about. But I'm saying to John, going forward, I would express, they're in a design phase now, so we're not in a construction phase yet. That won't happen for a year. And I would imagine there's opportunities under DEIR, Bob, or anything like that, that we would get a chance to comment on any plans, any designs.
Well, I guess I reiterate the necessity of better communication, not only from North Reading to Reading, but from Reading to its ancillary groups that are.
Well, we'll tell you what we know, but Bob, you have.
The only thing I can say is I can't tell you what I don't know.
Right.
I got the note that I passed along to Jonathan the week before, expecting another heads up, we're gonna start tomorrow. He said, okay, we'll get the team together. And again, we learn a lot from dealing with our neighbors. We know what we would do.
Right.
Whether that's boards or town managers, we don't always know what they do. So I assumed something, and maybe I shouldn't have, and all of a sudden they were there. It was quite a surprise. So, you know, I can't really pass along things I don't know, other than I knew there was something that was going to happen. I just didn't know where and when. And I also knew it was described to me as relatively minor in scope. Important, but right. Relatively, you know, half day, day's work. It wasn't
again,
a
that's the bridge,
job.
Not the.
And it was, just to make clear, no one said this, it was all fully in North Reading,
right.
All the work they did. I think when they were on site, they now want to come to Reading's Conservation Committee, and I asked that the Historic Commission be invited. They may have uncovered a need to do some work in Reading. I don't know. I haven't been told that, and I talked to their guy today. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay.
Gina has
I just had a question. So was North Reading in Reading doing work on our bridge? Was that?
They had a contractor that had parked a couple vehicles in Reading, but they were doing all the work in North Reading.
So what was the work that was being done on the bridge? Isn't the bridge in Reading?
Half and half.
Yeah.
So they're working on the North Reading side.
Yeah.
A couple hands up here. Yes.
Hi, I'm Gina Snyder. I'm on the Reading North Reading Stream Team and a volunteer with the Watershed Association. I've been monitoring at the Mill Street Bridge for years. I did actually point out a problem with the granite abutment on the northwest side of the bridge. The rocks have been moved. I believe when North Reading came in with the backhoe and fiddled with the beaver dam, because the house upstream, I think, has a septic system that was being affected by the water backup. Those abutment granite slabs are actually not supporting the bridge anymore. So I was surprised when I saw the DOT report saying that they were more concerned with the northeast side of the bridge. I would really like to see some engineers go out there and look at two things. One, they borrowed rocks from the riverbed. They took rocks out of the riverbed to use in the work that they did. The other thing is it didn't really look like it was very substantial work. So I think maybe one of our engineers might want to check it and see, and maybe with the Conservation Commission to see if any damage was done to the riverbed. Thank you.
Pause for a second. I understand we're practicing out there. But
let me just say one thing. Just so you know, Ryan Percival, our town engineer, spent most of Thursday out there. So both he and our conservation have a pretty good idea of what's going on. He hasn't shared any opinions of concern with me, but they are definitely aware of what has gone on.
All right, thank you.
Yep. Virginia, yes.
Too early. Rewind.
Whose side of the bridge is this on?
Well, it's difficult to say because Reading owns land on the other side of the river. Most people mm-hmm. don't realize
okay.
because that's where the mill was. So,
is there stuff on the other side? I don't know what I'm looking at.
Do we
Yeah, that's the new stone, right?
Yes, they put that as infill on top of it. But this is the actual rebuilding here. It looks like a lot of round rocks from the riverbed.
Oh, they're putting in riprap to try to break the water flow away from the, undermining the wall. Instead of bringing in riprap, which would have been, that's all river-based stone.
Right.
Looks like it actually may have ended up in the wall or something.
Yeah, some of it.
That's a pretty common technique.
I understand they were using leftover granite for fill.
Of course, this is all dry now, because that's why you want to do it now.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Joe.
I simply can't resist the opportunity to make the comment that what happened this weekend is water under the bridge.
You wish, yeah.
No, there's no water.
You wish.
But having said that, in all seriousness, in response to Selectman Ensminger, if I can, I, with respect to the DER process, that is the process that the parties are obligated by the law to have the discussion about. And I simply wanted to reiterate, as I had said before, I strongly request that that the Selectmen not wait and that the town not wait until after the design phase before the parties of interest, meaning the Conservation Commission and the Historic Commission, have an opportunity to speak with or to at least be aware of what's going on and speak in an effort to try to address or mitigate the potential damage rather than wait until after the design process. Thank you.
Bob, could I suggest that you draft a letter that myself, Chairman Halsey, and you will sign to the North Reading Board of Selectmen expressing some of these concerns and making a request for the path forward being followed the way we've been speaking tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thanks, folks.
Any other firm of public comment? Mr. Brown.
I'm tired. We just had about 40 people in our sanitary board.
I saw that.
I've got to tell you.
What are you doing in here?
They want a sign in the cemetery announcing the potential of a new building being there. So we're going to put it in all four cemeteries in conjunction with the building committee. But that's not the reason I wanted to.
Got to get a permit first.
I know. Not when they're in our own cemetery.
We're not exempt.
I know.
Under me.
I know that the land on the across from Oakland Road is under consideration for sale. At our scuttlebutt meeting on Thursday, there were a group of people that came out and talked to us. And one of the things they came up, there's an acute need for housing for veterans, especially disabled veterans. And I don't know if the Selectmen would entertain that as a thought, perhaps. I don't know. Is the land up for sale or coming up for November?
As you know, since you started it all, we want to make sure we have a clear title.
Yeah, exactly.
And there's two articles that have to go to town meeting to do that. One to fix something that the last town meeting didn't do fully. And then the other, if town meeting wishes.
I missed something.
Somebody did. To authorize the board to sell it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So there's nothing on the horizon, although there is someone who might like to come see you in the next 2 months with a plan.
Mm-hmm.
But until I hear back a second time, I can't know that.
Right.
So it's really just to get it to that next step, and then the board can entertain uses.
Okay.
And could that be a topic for a 40B, friendly 40B?
It could be, but that's not the way I was approached. It's a different use,
okay.
But anything is possible.
Okay.
Well,
you
first,
know,
yeah,
for,
first
the,
things,
for
first
the town to sell land, it has to do it
has
through
to
an RFP,
own.
So it has to advertise. Well, yeah, it has to own
right.
it. It has to advertise, so it's
yeah.
nothing will sneak in.
And these articles are going on in November.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
And while I'm on that, one of the things that came up at the Permanent Building Committee was that somebody heard a rumor that the present building in Laurel Hill was been sold. We told them absolutely not.
How much you get for it?
I think I missed that town meeting.
Condos.
Yes.
There's a lot of misinformation flying
yes,
around
there is.
About the building, unfortunately. And I think a lot of people, you know, they said, well, we're getting bounced around from one board to the other. I said, well, welcome to the government. I said, the wheels grind slowly. I've been at this for 10 years.
Yeah.
And 49 years of town government. So the wheels do grind slow, very slow at times. That,
all right.
I wish, you know, select as much as I want to see it on the tight road, I think a good use would be photograph evidence.
Yeah, I mean, once we know what we can do with that, I would say everything's a fair game. You know, I don't think you're gonna find this board, especially Bill, that wants to look at one option and one option only on anything. So I think anything would be fair discussion at that point, certainly. Thank you for bringing it up, actually.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill.
Is there any other public comment? Seeing none, the town manager?
Two quick things. You know, we have a bagpipe playing. On the page three of tonight's handout, just to let the board know, I just found this out. There's a Pete Muscarello ballpark dedication scheduled for September 17th with a rain date of the 18th. So just to call your attention to that. And then another thing we learned today, which is very troubling, there's at least three residents that reported that the Reading firefighters were calling them to seek charitable donations, but they're not. So these are fraudulent charities that are looking to, you know, part you from some of your funds. So just to be clear, there is no current Reading firefighter charitable outreach in the community. If anyone calls seeking those funds, you may as well just hang up. It is not us. The police chief and the police department is aware of this. If anyone has any more information, they're always welcome to call the police department and give them any advice they can. So that's just unfortunate when things like that happen. But I have heard it through the media that it's happened in some of the towns around us, south of us.
I've had the police, somebody calling on behalf of Reading Police, and of course you ask two or three questions and they can't answer any of them, and it's obviously bogus.
Yeah, okay.
But I could imagine somebody wanting to do the right thing might
sure,
easily take
absolutely.
It on face value.
Yep.
Thanks.
So with that, let the bagpipes play.
Get
the firefighters.
Bring them in.
This is our second bagpipe pinning ceremony, I believe.
This is.
Third. We had one in the senior center and one here.
Oh, I'm talking about here. This is our second one here.
Oh, yeah.
This is my third.
Some seats up front too, so feel free, come on in.
Yeah, we have five seats up front.
Feel free to go all the way down on the sides.
Some box
too.
Seats down in front.
We have two up here.
And you guys can wind around too.
Yeah.
Hey, Chief.
Hey, Bill. You're on number now.
Huh?
This is even a bigger crowd.
Yeah, they figured out something nice.
Keep going.
Yeah, all the way through, all the way around.
Yep. Thanks for the police never gets us back.
Thanks. That's true.
You guys can come over here if you'd like.
Keep filing all the way down the edge here. Feel free.
Yep.
We'll get everybody in here.
He's one of us.
Relax.
Still three seats up front.
Oh, that's it.
I'd like to say thank you to the Board of Selectmen for having us here tonight. And also thank you, Firefighter John Keel, for playing the bagpipes. He does a great job with it. And thank you for all the friends and family that came and for the firefighters that came. It's a nice event for us. It's been about 12 years since we've had promotions in the department. We're undergoing a little bit of a transition phase right now. So we have four promotions and two new hires. So it's exciting for us. So tonight I'd like to introduce to you our new promotions and also our new firefighters in the badge. And I'd like to start with Assistant Chief Paul Jackson.
Paul's been with the Reading Fire Department since January of 1983. He was promoted to lieutenant in April of 1990, promoted to day officer in September of 2002, and promoted to assistant chief in on April 15th, 2016. So I'd like to say, thank you. He's a great guy. Paul has a associate's degree in fire protection and safety from Bunker Hill Community College. He's also an emergency medical technician. He served as the department's fire prevention officer since 2002, and he really knows the building codes and fire prevention codes backwards and forwards. Also since 2007, he's been a member of NEMLIC's STARS program. And of course we know NEMLIC is a police program, but the STARS program deals with school threat assessment and response. And Paul's been a very active member of that team. And it's designed to assist school systems prepare and respond to any type of disaster. Paul also served as a member of the Middlesex County District Attorney's Office Juvenile Fire Setting Program, where he taught programs to kids that lit fires. He's a certified fire officer, certified fire inspector, and he's taken a number of certifications in fire investigation and advanced fire investigation. So he's been in this position since April. He's doing a fantastic job. And
is that my review?
Not yet.
We've had some email discussions.
Yeah, the chief and I have talked.
So tonight, Paul's sister,
daughter Christine,
is going to do the honor. Yep.
Cool.
Now's your chance to get back at it.
Thanks, Chief. Congratulations.
Yep. Chief. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Chief.
Tonight I'd like to introduce you to Captain Mark Dwyer. Mark has been with the Reading Fire Department since August of 1988. He was promoted to lieutenant in February of 2004. He was promoted to captain in July of 2016. Mark has a master's in emergency services management from Columbia Southern. He also has a MBA in general business management from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. He also has a bachelor's of business administration and marketing from the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. He also has an associate's degree in fire safety, protection, and technology from North Shore Community College. He's also an emergency medical technician. Mark has a number of certifications. He's a fire officer 1 and 2 and 3, fire instructor 1 and 2. He's a fire inspector 1 and 2, hazardous materials technician. He's taking the incident safety officer course for fire suppression and hazardous materials, and also the fire prevention officer basic. Mark also has contributed to the department in the area of the Senior Safe program. Mark developed the program here in Reading and got it off the ground, and he's been delivering it since 2013. And that program deals with seniors and delivering programs for fall and also other fire safety and injury prevention program. So it's been a great program, and Mark's been working hard at it. And he's also assisted us in securing grants for that program. So Mark, I'd like to say congratulations on behalf of the position.
Thank you.
Who's going to
My wife will.
Marge.
My wife, Marge.
Marge is going to do the honors of the badge. I'd also like to introduce you to Captain Rick Nelson. Rick's been a firefighter. Rick started as a firefighter in July of 1997. He was promoted to lieutenant in November of 2003, and promoted to captain in July of 2016. Rick has a bachelor's in science and fire science management from Salem State College. He's an emergency medical technician. He has certified fire officer 1 and 2, firefighter 1 and 2, fire instructor 1 and 2, fire inspector, roof rescue technician, structural collapse technician 1 and 2. Rick has been our training officer for a number of years and goes to the different groups and delivers training programs to the groups to get us as a cohesive one department. He also has served on the Essex County Technical Rescue Team for a number of years. That's an innovative program that started in Essex County. We've seen it kind of expand in the state a little bit with 3 other teams coming up. And it deals with rescuing people from trenches, building collapses, and things like that. And they've done a tremendous amount of training with the National Guard and other teams. And it's a very impressive program. So I'd like to say congratulations. Rick's father
and mother.
Rick's father is a retired Reading police officer. He's going to do the honors. Didn't recognize you.
I took my hat off.
That's right.
Stays in the family.
Tonight I'd like to introduce you to Lieutenant Tony Delsigori. Tony has been a firefighter since September of 1994. He was promoted to lieutenant in July 15. Tony's currently enrolled in the Columbia Southern University's bachelor's degree program. He has an associate's degree in fire science from Middlesex Community College. He's an emergency medical technician. Tony's been the union president for over 10 years. He's also been very involved in our community outreach programs in CPR and the SAFE program for a number of years. Tony is a firefighter 1 and 2. He's also a fire officer 1 and 2. So I'd like to say congratulations to Tony. Welcome to the office.
My number one grandson.
Welcome, Lieutenant.
Congratulations.
I'd also like to introduce you to our 2 new firefighters. This is Brian Roach. Brian, his first day was August 15th. So he's currently enrolled in the Fire Academy. This week, the Academy's closed for some renovations, so we have him back at the department, so you might see him around the next couple of days. Today he was doing EMS training to get him up to speed on our protocols. Ryan has an associate's degree in fire science from Middlesex Community College. He has 6 years experience in the EMS field, working in some very busy systems. He's also worked for Catalba Ambulance and Lifeline Ambulance. He's a certified paramedic, and so we're glad to have him.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Welcome to Reading. You got the girl now.
Oh boy.
This is Eric Bollier. Eric also joined us in August 15th, 2016, also enrolled in the Fire Academy. Eric has firefighting experience as a call firefighter in Rockport. He was also hired to work as a full-time firefighter in Newbury, where he's promoted to lieutenant. He has 6 years' experience in EMS. He's completed the Massachusetts Firefighting Academy's call and volunteer program, and he's working on completing his associate's degree in fire science at North Shore Community College. So glad to have him here. Welcome. Eric's wife is going to be doing the Reading firefighters that came, families, Reading police officers that came. Thank you very much for coming out. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Real quick, just before the bagpipes get going, which will drown me out fast. I'd just like to say, you know, this happens not so often here for those in the room. Thank you for all the family that have come. I'm sure the support of all the firefighters, the captain, lieutenant, and assistant chief is greatly appreciated by everybody. And just for us as Selectmen, this is one of the more fun evenings that we get to have coming here and watch you have this ceremony. So it's always makes us proud to see these kind of things and this kind of camaraderie amongst the division. So thank you all very much for those who are getting promoted, and thank you for all the family who support.
How many guys are left back at the fire station? Very good.
The hustle buggy is still there.
Best of luck on Thursday.
Thanks for coming tonight, Bob. We appreciate it. Oh, absentee or what?
Yeah, no, I'll be there.
See you guys.
Bye.
Yeah, you're a little bit.
children do pinnings, we had wives do pinnings, we had grandparents. We had the full family tree.
Sure.
No, we've lost the town manager, so.
Yep.
We're not going anywhere.
I move that the board of selectmen get a.
Yes.
Yeah.
Ted, just I'll take a 10% increase.
Yeah.
It can't be effective till the following term, though. It's part of the bylaw.
Can we just rock and roll?
I think we can.
Yeah, we can.
I think we can handle the appointments on our own, I'll be back.
Yeah.
Sure.
Call the board of selectmen back to order.
Move that the board of selectmen accept the recommendation of the volunteer appointment subcommittee as follows. Beth Mosier to the cultural council with a term expiring June 30th, 2018.
Second. Just a few words about Beth. She's a very qualified member to be on the cultural council. She's I'll take any phones I can get there. She's an active member of the arts community in Reading for over 30 years and is currently the artistic director of the Reading Community Chorus and co-director of Kids Sing, which is an after-school show choir, which focuses on singing, dancing, and acting. So congratulations to Beth.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Is there any comment? Seeing none, all those in favor? Okay. Next up on our meeting agenda, seeing we're past the hour, we have a continued hearing for the transfer of liquor license from Brooks Brew and Fine Wines, 676 Main Street to Anastasi Brookline, 25 Walker's Brook Drive. I believe we have some representatives here. All right, Reed, you're on.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Andrew Upton representing the applicant. The board with me is Tasso Giannopoulos, the 100% owner and proposed manager of record. I'd like to hand out just a copy of our alcohol compliance program. I'll give you my description. I'll give a brief description of the concept. Mr. Giannopoulos would like to make a brief statement about his experience, and then I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Great.
Tonight we're seeking approval for the transfer of the Brooks Brew package store license to a concept known as the Liquor Isle to be located at Stop and Shop. Liquor Isle would be a sublessor of 900 square feet in an isolated, protected area of the supermarket where no crossover of supermarket customers would be. They're allowed to come in, but no one is forced to come in, and it's delineated, as you can see in the floor plan, so that people don't sort of drift in or come in unnecessarily. There's a kind of a strong separation there. We are not Stop and Shop. We are a tenant of Stop and Shop. Mr. Giannopoulos is a local and experienced Massachusetts independent package store owner and operator. As I said before, this license is coming out of the bankruptcy of Brooks Brew, aka Reading Fine Wine, right down the street. The first thing that we'd like you to consider is the character and fitness of the applicant. Tasso is an established manager, he's an established operator and owner, and he's been previously approved by local boards and the Massachusetts AUCC. He's an enthusiastic owner, he has a green record, he's making a personal financial commitment. He has a track record of success at his other locations, and he has no violations of any kind. We believe there is a public need for a liquor license in this location. Supermarkets all over Massachusetts have liquor, and the trend is for them to increase that amenity and opportunity. As you know, the limit went from 3 licenses per chain up to 7, and it's going up to 9 in the future. Stop and Shop has told us, and their customers have told us, that they want liquor at the supermarket as a convenience. They want one-stop shopping. I believe that may be one reason why Brooks down the street didn't make it, because it was not a little more difficult to park. It's a separate destination, and customers of supermarkets have indicated a clear preference for being able to have a convenience facility like this on site. We'd be putting a dormant license back into circulation. We believe this would be a low-impact use of a liquor license because it would have no additional impact on traffic, noise, or other negative neighborhood impacts, since pretty much everyone is going to the supermarket already. So that is our overview of the concept. I'd like Mr. Giannopoulos to give you a brief statement, and we'd be glad to answer any questions.
Great.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for having me. I just wrote it out so I don't jump all over the place.
Sure. To keep That's fine.
We do the same thing.
Oh, I bring my glasses, which is, good evening. My name is Tasso Giannopoulos. It's really Anastasios Giannopoulos, but for obvious reasons, for some reason, she cut out the Tasso for short, so feel free to call me Tasso.
Okay.
In 2000, I founded and operated a liquor import and wholesale distribution company in Massachusetts. I ran that for about 10 years, and then I transferred it to my wife in 2010, and it's still an active business. I went on to pursue the retail aspect of the liquor industry. So I opened up stores in Boston, in Brookline, in Newton, in Somerville. These stores and their communities were all very different. There were freestanding stores, college community stores, suburban stores, and stores within a supermarket. All offered very different challenges. My experience was built by trial and error by creating stores from licenses to full operation, including everything aspect of operation and management in between. I've experienced in the permitting stage, construction, staffing, operations, sales and service, and product development of retail package stores. My two most exciting stores were the stores within the supermarket concept on Commonwealth Ave in Boston, in Upper Alston, and on McGrath Highway in Somerville. It was rewarding to be part of a process that provided convenience, selection, and fair prices to the communities that supported these establishments. These stores enhanced the brand identity of the markets, and the customers really appreciated the convenience and safety of being able to purchase their liquor items inside the store. It was a safe and great attraction and was a popular alternative to other stores in the area. Within a month, I will only have ownership of a Brookline store. And if approved for a license in Reading, I will be on site from the construction through the opening as the manager of record. As an experienced operator with strong track record, I'm looking to build a relationship with you and the town and my landlord, Stop and Shop. And I've heard from customers that there is a public need for convenience, selection, and safe alcohol sales environment that I will bring to the Reading. I ask for your support in this application. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Open up to the board for any questions it may have. John?
Tasso, the concept here is you're taking a license from formerly wine, and I guess they had beer to some extent. I don't recall the wine shop if it served beer, but primarily wines. But you're talking about liquors as well. Is that correct?
It was an all-alcohol license.
They had beer, wine, and spirits.
Mostly wine, but they had a smaller.
They had the right to sell it, but they just elected not to.
They elected not to. Mm-hmm. This is a little bit outside of the swim lane I'm familiar with. Historically in Reading, in that although the former Atlantic supermarket maybe broke the mold here for you years ago, it narrowed itself only to beer and wine, and we knew the family very closely, so there was a kindred spirit, if you will, in terms of enforcement and oversight. You mentioned moments ago that you'd be on the manager of record until opening. What's your plan after opening in terms of?
I'm going to stay on. I'm sorry, I wrote it a little wrong, but that's what I was going to do. I'm going to focus on this location here.
Okay.
The one concern I would have is only that this concept, I'm not sure if it provides less or more opportunity for, frankly, abuse from, you know, from kids coming in and wanting to see if they could test the measures that are put in place to defeat them. We've had a couple of incidents of that sort in the last several years. And my own opinion is that I'd be interested in giving it a try, but I'd be also interested in looking at any negative outcomes pretty swiftly, because this is going to be brand new. You're in the middle of a busy environment. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of confusion. It's there's shopping carts all over the place as opposed to a normal liquor store. So my concern would be just that, does it lend itself to more kinds of abuse just because of the environment it's in, not because of what you're doing? You're kind of running a store within a store. It's the confusing part of it. Is your intention to put shopping carts up and down those aisles? Is that your intention?
No. So that way this is actually only 900 square feet. So this is like
that's what I heard. Right.
So it's a very small area.
So you're blocking the carts from getting in.
It's a very small area in the corner of the front of the store.
Right.
So
it's almost the size of this room. Yeah.
Is it where the customer service?
Or is it the
By the produce?
By the tables.
No, no, it's like right when you come in
by the north
door on the left.
A bunch of tables there.
The bank is there, just next to the bank.
Oh, okay.
It's like a seating area that
right.
nobody sits in.
Yeah, generally, I think right now employees use it for like their lunch break. They'll go
Correct.
Grab something. They'll go sit
Correct.
At the table set up. It's really, I think they wanted to have a cafe there, but that never really.
For me personally, from my experiences, because I've had both types
yep.
of stores,
yep.
and this is just me saying, this to me is a safer environment, only because there's so many people all the time that you see. That to me is a plus. And there's only one entrance and exit where it's the space is so small that there's a clear
inside.
View of sight the whole time. And I fully take, obviously, responsibility with that as the owner and the manager of record. And I would expect the board, if something were to happen, because things do happen, you know, in many different fields, that I would be answering for those,
sure.
those situations. So I have no concern with that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Dan, go ahead. Yeah, there's a few things that comfort me about this compared to Atlantic. Number one, it's confined to one specific area of the
right.
store. It's not kind of going to be a movable feast
right.
around the store,
right. and a growing feast.
Which became, I think, a real issue with Atlantic. Carding all customers, regardless of age, I like that policy. Not
it's
selling
it's
candy. And, yeah.
Well, even number two.
I'll offer it up.
Well, number two, I think, is as encouraging as number one on his list, which they'll card everyone in the group, not just the
yes.
person buying.
Yeah,
yeah, not even allowed.
I think one and two go very, very hand in hand with a good practice and policy.
Yeah. And the fact you're hiring your own mystery shopper, of course,
yes.
well, you may see youth coming in, and you'll never know, you know, who they're being sent by or sending themselves in. So the police do hire.
We'll have our own mystery shoppers as well.
Yeah.
Yes, we will.
Chief, just so you guys know that I spoke to the chief in detail about it, and I don't know if he told you guys, but feel free to ask him about our conversation and everything that you know we said. But he was very, I just talked to him outside also, very comfortable with that.
Yeah, we got a letter from the chief saying that he saw no reason not to move forward with
oh,
this.
Great.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
I mean, one of the things that was troublesome when we had it at the Atlantic was that it's part of the general population of the store. So
mm-hmm.
if you had, you know, a high school junior who was working the checkout line, you know, you went,
yeah, to pull them
you
off
went with your tomatoes and your bottle of beer, and they had to call someone to ring you in, and the lines got bigger. So I'm assuming, just for the layout, I'm looking at the floor plan here. It's hard for me to kind of envision sort of how. You know,
can I stand up?
There's a
register. Yeah, please, yeah.
There's a register up there.
So right over here.
Sort of, you know, how you
sorry.
Get in, get out, and
if you remember, these are the doors where you come in, or
yep.
entrance.
Yep. For Stop and Shop.
So this is all blocked off. This is all closed up until this point.
Okay.
This is all closed. You see this door here? This is just to an elevated machine room that has the fire department has to leave open.
Sure.
Again, all blocked off, so there is nothing else here. This is the only way that somebody can come in. In and out. Is
so they have to be already
right
in the
here.
Store. They can't enter from
Correct.
Outside.
They can't enter from outside, so you already have to be in the store. And then once you enter this, everybody will be screened, for lack of a better term, to come in and exit. So it's actually very secure in this area. That's the only way that people can come.
So you'll be checking IDs at the point of entering the area?
If somebody, yeah, of course, within reason. But if there's groups of, say, a group of kids come in, to get some, they're not even gonna, it's not worth it for any amounts of sale or for
yeah.
anything to even allow them in. So even other things that, like, you know, people hanging around outside, I know the liquor stores have a tough time, even the freestanding ones with people staying outside and one
mm-hmm.
person coming in, and it's tough to police that, but you gotta work with your police department and with your staff to do it, and that's what we do. We continuously do that. So that's, it's definitely our intentions to be doing that.
Okay. A lot of the liquor stores in the area host from time to time wine or beer or whiskey tastings.
Yeah.
Would you be doing that?
I would probably be doing it, but I wouldn't be doing it with liquor, only because my concept is more to pair with food items, and that goes back to the liquor department. The liquor industry is changing dramatically with these big box stores that are coming in that, you know, people see, and frankly, there's not a lot of money in the actual liquor. It's a more of a convenience aspect with that to keep the store alive. But the wine is where, especially with the supermarket, when the supermarket has a great sale on sushi this week, for example,
the liquor reps will be pairing a special that week with something that goes with that. So it's a lot more interesting, it's a lot more educational, it's a lot more, you know, and that's kind of like what the people want.
And so there'll be interaction between this, the supermarket and your store, just, you know.
If I see, like, Valentine's Day when they're putting up balloons and they're champagne, you know, people are going to be able to, you know, come and get champagne on sale or something like that, just kind of with the trending times and things like that.
That doesn't mean they'll be having samples out on the floor.
Oh, no, everything is within our buyers. Right. So.
Can you say a few more words about the co-marketing you expect to do? What will the co-marketing look like on special occasions like Valentine's Day, like New Year's, like sushi?
It would just strictly be off of, and then I just said this randomly, it would be off of if they're doing some kind of special for Valentine's Day, the same thing that everybody else would be doing at every liquor store, which would be champagnes.
So you have signage up in that area that might remind them to come wander by this
for champagnes, whereas going back to the question of the tastings, that's what every liquor store will be doing at that time, pretty much tastings of champagne to try to.
And if you do them, it's within the dotted line.
It would be within the dotted line, absolutely, yes.
Bob, do we have anything on for Sunday's time restrictions, start and stop?
Only by the state, they set them. And I can't remember, it's now, it's very early in the morning.
No, it's earlier than
noon. No, it's earlier than noon now. It's 10, right?
10 to 11.
Yeah. Okay, so 10 to 11.
We got to grant the waivers. We had to.
Yeah.
Remember the Atlantic, they used to have to cover it. They covered it up
with
like a sheet or something.
No. Okay, and I think you stated that, you know, before you're going to be open, just the hours that Stop and Shop is, for obvious reasons. So are there times when Stop and Shop's closed? Special holidays? I don't think so, right? Well,
they
Thanksgiving
or
something like that, but
I don't
remember. They'll be closed, too.
Yeah, I don't think you want to be open on Thanksgiving either.
Yeah, no. you can't legally anyway.
Yeah, right? Okay. Okay, any other further comments from the board?
Order question.
Yeah.
Have you talked with Stop and Shop as to what you expect sort of the customer flow to be? Are they going to grocery shop first, come to you on the way out, vice versa, anything?
I haven't gone into details like that because we're two separate companies and, you know, they're a big corporation, you know, it's hard to talk to anybody pretty much, you know, so it's really just renting the space.
We try to get a bus easement, you know. Okay, I was just curious.
One more question.
Yeah.
Is there an occupancy limit to that space that you're aware of?
Yeah, there's got
to
be.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'll find out.
It'll be posted.
Okay.
Go ahead, Barry.
This is more a question for Bob. This doesn't impact you guys. I think I know the answer to this question, but I just want you to tell me again. You know, here it is. We charge a nominal fee for a liquor license, and someone, to come in and get it. Yet they're worth lots and lots of money. There's no way for the town of Reading to sort of a wheeling charge. Like we do with water, when it passes hands. I mean, it just seems like it's, you know, we charge, what, 25, 50 bucks?
Oh, no, it's much more than that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
thousands.
No, it's a couple thousand.
A couple thousand.
Yeah, 3,000 or something like that.
Big money.
But
I know they go for it's certainly not the market value of them.
No, I don't think we're on commission. I think
I just
we could try a home rule petition. My sense is that I wouldn't pass.
I
but no, that's the free market.
Nickels under every stone. So, I just had to ask.
No, it does have a value. Every license has some value. Most of them not much, but this one has good value. And taxi medallions used to have good value until Uber came along. So watch out.
Uber liquor.
With that being said, is there anyone in the public comment? So being an open hearing, seeing none.
Move to close the hearing on the transfer of the liquor license, pledge of license, change of location, and appointment of manager from Brooks Brew and Fine Wine, 676 Main Street, to Anastasi Brookline Incorporated, DBA Reading Fine Wine and Spirits, 25 Walkers Brook Drive.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yes.
Before there's a motion.
There is.
We have secured an individual lender to lend the money instead of Radius Bank, as is on the application.
Okay.
And the individual lender is not requesting a pledge. So if you were to make a motion to approve, I would suggest that you could leave out the pledge part.
Pledge of license.
The pledge of license. Pledge of license,
okay.
Excuse me. And
that's
I will
fine.
Swap in with the clerk two appropriate pages.
Yep. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for pointing that out.
As amended.
As amended, there you go. Good way to put it. Okay, we have a second. All those in favor closing the hearing? 4-0. Motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the transfer of the liquor license, change of location, and appointment of manager from Brooks Brew and Fine Wines, 676 Main Street to Anastasi Brookline Incorporated, DBA Reading Fine Wine and Spirits, 25 Walker's Brook Drive, with a term expiring December 31st, 2016, subject to the following conditions.
Yeah, keep going.
Yep.
Oh, okay. All bylaws, rules, and regulations of the Town of Reading and the Commonwealth of Mass shall be followed and also subject to a satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the town manager or his designee.
Second.
All right, with a second on the table, before we take a motion on that, I would just like to say, I personally think this is a good idea for that location, for that spot. I'm very happy to see the list that you provided to us tonight. I think it's, you know, from a compliance standpoint, and just from your own, you know, doing business standpoint, I think it's a good idea. You know, I'd be remiss to not say, though, you know, it's welcoming you, you know, if we're welcoming you to Reading, to make sure that you understand that, you know, as well as your shopper, as you've heard, we'll probably have our own in there. And we've certainly been very swift and harsh in the past with folks that have had issues with serving to kids, anyone under 21 years old, I should say. So I think this is a good thing moving forward, but I would just remind you to stay vigilant on that list that you provide. I think it's a great one.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Being said, all those in favor? 4-0. Welcome to Reading.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Good luck.
When will you
open? I got to think about a lot of things.
Tasso, very nice to meet you.
Nice
congratulations.
Meeting you.
Good
luck.
Welcome to town. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay.
Good luck.
All the cards, all the stuff. I just need copies.
All right, where are we? So next up we have a Chipotle request for a liquor policy waiver. Want to take us to that, Bob?
Sure. In a similar process to this, Chipotle was granted a liquor license. I never knew they served liquor, but younger people knew that. And upon inspection by the chief, he learned that they were serving in plastic cups. So again, I had never been in. What do I know? They didn't know you had a policy that forbid it. We didn't know that was their intention in their application process. They didn't think to go into that kind of detail, and none of us really were just aware of that. So we notified them that the selectmen do have an alcohol policy that forbids that, except by special permission, usually for something like New Year's. And I have to say, they were really good about stopping right away.
Mm-hmm.
They were very good from a compliance standpoint. They had no issues at all. They appreciated the sort of the heads up, the warning. They do not have the capacity in their stores to do dishwasher. They don't have glassware. They don't have plates. Okay, so everything is paper and plastic, which I get.
Beer too, not just the margaritas.
Just the margaritas. I think that's all they serve is margaritas.
Yeah, they were here the other night. It's just margaritas.
Is it just margaritas?
Yeah. So they said if the board was going to require glassware, they would simply never serve margaritas in this establishment. And again, although that's their preference, they have plenty of Chipotles that do not have an alcohol license, certainly. So in discussing this with Chairman Halsey and a little bit with Vice Chair Sexton tonight, the only sort of fly in the ointment, as it were, is the board's liquor policy, as you know, is being under review by Town Council.
Mm-hmm.
So you will see a draft of changes with the goal of November, because on December 1st you renew alcohol licenses. So the clear goal is to button up a new policy in the month of November with one or two meetings.
I would hope this plastic versus glass is something you're revisiting. And
well, it certainly wasn't until this came up. It just hadn't dawned on any of us.
I'm not sure what the operational
requirement is. Paula has background. Why don't you share the background with the board?
Yeah, that goes way back. It was basically we had some females on the board, and
mm-hmm.
they were concerned that fast food restaurants would be applying.
Well, here you go.
That was for the town board.
Oh, this is a way to kind of limit it.
To
I see.
Limited, yeah. That was basically the reason, you know, from China and so forth.
Okay. So it's certainly a valid point of discussion when the policy is being reviewed. Then the question for the board is, do you want to entertain a waiver until such time, or do you want to just have them wait? And honestly, I don't think they have a big problem either way, because they've stopped voluntarily, really, although they knew it was against your policy. And they said, let us know when the select, and I told them all about the policy being revisited. They said, you just let us know what the selectmen will let us do. Mm-hmm. Fine.
So they were good citizens all along?
Absolutely.
No calls, no police calls?
No,
there,
really, really very good.
When they were in the other night, they actually were a 2-drink minimum, have to order food with both.
Yep.
Right.
2-liter maximum, excuse me.
And I think we went through the whole drill of, you know, how do you do it, why do you do it? It's limited to margaritas, and the only issue is the plastic cups.
Yeah.
And I imagine there's some ancillary benefit in terms of breakage, because it's outdoors as well, right?
Right.
It's an outdoor component. So.
Plus,
right.
Plus, it helps the environment. Less water.
Less water, and you can recycle plastic now, which may be way back when it was more throwaway. But
I think of the water more than the, yeah.
I'm not sure where the head of the board is, but I'd be inclined to grant the waiver. And
I would, too.
The, when this comes around again and gets rewritten, we'll take a look at it.
We have to think about, you know, kind of if we do it just as a waiver, it just applies to them.
Correct.
We can still potentially keep it in place to, you know, prevent it from being quote unquote less classy and still get the waiver to them, I guess, supposedly.
Well, no one else has approached us. You raise a good point. Would somebody else come over? You need a restaurant that has presumably outdoor, well, maybe it doesn't outdoor, mm-hmm. an outdoor has doesn't matter. But
in terms of the prior concern of the ladies on the prior board, I would say this board has full authority to withhold licenses as it sees
anyway,
fit,
yeah.
On the basis right. of that verbiage about community need.
Correct.
Right.
Because we have a certain number to give out.
Right.
So I think we have a lot of tools at our disposal and don't need to
yeah.
artificially constrain their business practices.
Yeah. I'd be inclined to let it go, and we'll take up the liquor license review when it comes around.
Yeah.
Bob, did you ask, I know we talked a little bit about this, I don't think there's a representative here tonight, obviously. Did you bring up the fact that we're reviewing our policies?
I did, but I didn't say to them, if the board gave you a choice, what would you do?
Yeah.
I just said the board is revisiting its policy, so if they do anything now, it's not the permanent decision
right.
in either
right.
direction. And they said, you know, again, we'll follow the wishes of the board.
Yeah, I'm just curious from business practice, if you gave them the option, said, you know, the rug might be pulled out from underneath you come the end of the year, you know, would you do it or not?
Right.
Would you want us to
it's
grant it
call.
Or not?
It's their call.
It
is.
It is. I'd just be curious to find out.
And a waiver is perpetual. It doesn't come.
Well, it would only go to December 31st by motion tonight, and then it would have to be renewed.
Okay. Right. That would be in the conditions of their
right. And by that time, we'll have a new policy, presumably.
Yes.
Yeah,
policy.
So
yeah.
I think it's self-limiting. We ought to just
yeah.
move ahead.
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm fine with just moving ahead. I mean,
sure.
Move of the Board of Selectmen grant a waiver of Section 3.2.2.2 of the Selectmen's policy for Chipotle to serve alcohol in plastic cups through December 31st, 2016.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 4-0.
Good luck.
Okay. Next on to Train Depot roof repairs, 32 Lincoln Street.
8:15, right on time.
Is there anyone
background
on
that,
nope.
Bob?
Yeah, I will. Let me find it.
Okay.
In 1985, a Board of Selectmen, many moons ago, I'll read the exact wording they put in. The present slate roof shall be kept in good repair and retained as long as possible at 32 Lincoln Street, which is the Train Depot building.
Mm-hmm.
The owner actually put together a very nice packet, which I shared with the board, which had not only the old references, but also a request that it was time, after 31 years, to really repair the roof in a big way. And it's just cost prohibitive to do it with slate. So they proposed some things that were, I'm certainly no expert, but seemed to be visually as close as you could come, material-wise. They also mentioned, at least, and this is not the main reason they wanted to bring this forward, but they felt it would be irresponsible not to mention there has been some safety issues with the current slate. I grew up in a slate house, so I know what it's like. You know, all of a sudden slate roofs just fall off when they want to. And I guess a couple of vehicles have been damaged from slate just falling onto windshields.
There's
so
also snow load that can
and
be problematic.
Snow load can, yeah, yeah. It sounded like an apple.
We're just
going
to
slide
I can bear
down.
Witness to the slate coming down over there. I just, coming out of the Swiss Bakers one day this winter, it happened. And it was not fun.
There's no grabbing on with a hammer. Believe me. Been there, done that. Thank you. No.
I'm gonna ask Bill a historical question. Wasn't there once a requirement that the depot be painted elephant gray, and they actually stood an elephant up next to it?
Don Winslow, he was the field driver at the time.
Yeah.
To do over, and I guess he actually couldn't figure what the hell a color gray was.
So they marched the elephant.
Yeah.
Little Yankee ingenuity.
I think they waived that provision some years ago.
So, what, Bob, you were mentioning something about materials they were thinking about redoing with. Obviously,
so
we don't
here,
have any
yeah,
purview
here's,
over.
Here's a letter from their attorney with the request, and then a letter from the roofing person just describing, you know, how much the repairs cost.
Okay.
I'll just read it. The new roof will consist of an architectural style asphalt shingle, which will help in keeping the look of the building elegant to aesthetics. I'm not quite sure what that is. And then some other benefits. You know, we ran into some of these issues, as Virginia will recall, in the library on the Portico share. And again, I'm the wrong person to ask in terms of expertise, but you know, visually, you have to be an expert to understand some of the differences, and I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
So when I look at some of the things the library did, I couldn't tell. But again, I'm the wrong one.
Well,
we
have a good resource here.
Sure, you certainly do. Yeah, I did a site visit earlier today just to take a look at it. And I, you know, it's funny how you look at buildings, you never actually really look at them. Until a problem or something in particular, a nice part of it is pointed out to you. So, you know, looking over this roof for really the first time looking at it on all four sides, it really is in tough shape. You can definitely see where they've filled in with different, over the years, different slate, you know, as repairs were needed. I would probably say easily all four sides needs a significant amount of repair, just from my naked eye, of looking at this, where you can see loose, cracked, crumbled, tile. So I can see how it, from an owner's standpoint, this is certainly continuing to keep something together that clearly wants to fall apart is becoming an expensive project to do. So,
Bob, is our only interest in the historical covenant around the condition of the roof? Is that our only involvement here?
I'm not sure what you mean. Give me a little more. I'd say safety would be our number one issue.
Yeah.
Sorry, we're here tonight because the safety issue comes first and foremost, but our involvement is all around the preservation of the current slate roof, that clause and only that clause.
I would say it's what's underlined behind me, clause D.
Okay.
A prior board put this in there. A current board should be the ones to take it out.
Mm-hmm.
We did do research. Per se, the building is not a historic building, and you know, otherwise we'd have gone to the historical commission first.
And it's owned by the Railroad Realty Trust.
Right.
It's a matter of opinion, correct, Virginia?
Oh, may I?
Please.
Actually, I believe the Railroad Depot is on the National Register. This was the first set of preservation restrictions that the town enacted because the town had purchased the building from the railroad man, or what it was at that point. And so
yep.
Then went, they tried some different activities in there, and then they decided to sell it to the public. And when that occurred, the Historical Commission did write the preservation restrictions, and it empowered the Board of Selectmen to keep track of this. And actually, there's about four sets of preservation restrictions on buildings here in Reading. So this is one, and I'd like to point out that the slate is a very character-defining issue on this building. The building is structurally built strong enough to support slate.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll remind you that when the town took over the Pleasant Street Center, that the town put on artificial slate at one point, and that failed quite miserably, so that they did go ahead, the town paid to have real slate put back on that building. Slate roofs will last 100 years. So the investment may be prohibitive, and certainly for an individual now to be footing that bill, but if they were to replace all that slate, it would last 100 years.
Right.
So this is a deed restriction, and we're the boss.
Virginia, when the library rebuilt the porte-cochere and took the slate off of that, did they replace it with slate, or was it like a slate light, or?
I haven't been up there.
It's a form of asphalt, I couldn't tell you what it is, again, I'm the wrong one.
We had issues with that, we were aiming for the slate as well.
Bill?
North Reading also did the artificial slate on, I believe, their library up there, their former town hall, and it again turned to a disaster.
Interesting.
I think the regular asphalt shingles should suffice.
What was it, what's artificial, is it the plastic composite?
Yeah, I don't know, some composite material.
Yeah, okay.
It looks like it, makes it look like.
Yeah, I've seen it on a couple of different houses before, okay.
And I think you gotta understand, perhaps, Jimmy, a lot of the slate came over as ballast in the ships years ago, that it was used for.
But a lot was also mined right here in the area as well, Vermont particularly. In fact, many specs call for Vermont slate.
Vermont green.
And excuse me, one more thing. The Historical Commission is meeting tomorrow night, and we didn't have a chance to give a position or encourage you one way or the other, because we haven't met till tomorrow night. So if you would care to hold off a little bit, we might be able to come up with some recommendations.
How time critical is this for the moment?
I don't think, I waited 31 years.
All right.
Wait another month.
I'd be willing to.
I think they do wanna do the repairs before the winter.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, do they have a schedule slated, because I hate to hear the schedule was, you know, Monday.
No, and well, certainly not that I'm aware of, I know.
A chunk of slate falls on Tuesday.
The library might work that way, but.
Virginia, I wanna accommodate you, but I wanna delay this. Can you come up with recommendations in a single meeting, or will it take longer than that?
No, I think we probably could, except we'd have a full agenda, but I think we'd give it a good effort.
All right, I don't have a problem putting this off to our next meeting.
Are we posted Monday, right?
You are posted Monday, you could do it then, or you could do it on the 20th. I don't think it matters from the applicant's standpoint, but certainly if you could do it Monday, that's as good as tonight.
As a practical matter, the alternatives are he removes it, or he keeps it in place and continues repairing it. And what he's saying is that it's not affordable, it's not an economic prospect. So while others may have an opinion, what the owner is telling us is that it's not economic to continue what he's been doing.
And if I might, from a legal standpoint, I'm not a lawyer, if you look at the conditions A, B, and C, it's shall do, and this one is D, as long as it's possible.
Yeah,
the owner's telling you it's not possible.
Arguably, that's the map.
The town does not have as firm a legal footing as if it just said, do this thing.
Mm-hmm. We're in no position to say what's possible and trump the argument.
Yeah, I don't think the applicant would mind at all having any kind of advice.
Well, I think that's all Virginia was looking for. I don't think you don't know the mind that, you know, replacing with slate is a must thing in your head. I'm asking you personally, not obviously what the commission's tolerance is on it.
In fact, I was one of the writers of those conditions, and knowing that sometimes slate does not last forever, so we left that a little ambiguous.
At your meeting, it would be helpful if maybe the applicant could make available the material that they would propose, so that at least you would be able to look at that and render an opinion one way or the other. I think that would be.
I can ask. Tomorrow night, Virginia?
Yes.
Yeah,
what time? 7?
You know, my inclination would be.
Next door.
Okay. My inclination would be obviously not to impose any kind of new slate roof to be installed on here, but I also don't see the really the harm if work is imminent. To let historical at least throw around, kick around a couple of ideas in regards to what maybe you could do that makes it look as architectural pleasing as it does it right now, and kind of keep that historic nature to it.
And we could add as a condition the motion that when they thank the owner or request that any replacement work be as close to the slate roof look, and that the applicant work with the historical commission to find suitable alternatives to slate.
That's true.
We could put that into our motion.
Within reason from a standpoint of an asphalt replication.
Or for that matter, we could do that tonight and just wait until they come up with their recommendations.
I'd be inclined, this is in our wheelhouse to take a look at it. I'm fine with the Historical Commission taking a look at it, but I wouldn't cede our responsibility to another group to make the call. Right?
No, but if there's 10 alternatives, then, you know, and, you know, we want to at least have some recommendation on the one that looks closest, that's the most feasible.
There's a recommendation made and paid.
Yeah, but I don't feel, you know, I don't know what that's gonna look like compared to the slate roof, and it'll be, you know, if we can have another set of eyes look at it, who's had history of that, and, you know, certainly we're not ceding the responsibility, but at least, you know, to say, you know, point A, you know, choice A is better than choice B.
The architectural shingles is pretty standard today, it's standard practice, they're a 25-year, it's a 30-year lasting shingle.
Double-layer shingle.
Double layer, they got a raised look to it, so it changes your eyes perspective, it's not the old flat, continual asphalt roof that you see, so it's a little bit different, but, you know, it's not going to look like slate, but it certainly would look, you know, look nice, just because it's a nicer shingle in general.
Do we wanna see it, or do we want others to see it on our behalf?
You know, I think the applicant here has probably paid a lot out to maintain where this roof is now. I think it should be on us to make sure that another board isn't imposing something too restrictive from a cost standpoint on to the applicant.
So better to wait and then act?
Correct.
So,
yeah.
Yeah, I can be in touch with the applicant tomorrow tomorrow. They may or may not be able to do anything for tomorrow night, I can't say that. But I'll just let them know they're on hold until they do.
Well, you know, I'd also ask them what their schedule is projected.
Yeah, if they can't do tomorrow night, then I'll give them the board's schedule and say if you could come in with a demonstration, we'll invite the historical commission, and that would be helpful.
And that will
You guys meet monthly, Virginia General?
Yes.
Yeah, so September 20th, aside from next Monday, is the next meeting, 2 weeks from tonight. So.
And that won't take long to do.
No, but I would like to know, maybe to keep us blacker for Monday, if work's imminent, the last thing I want to do is delay work and then have an accident happen.
Okay. I don't think work is imminent because they didn't necessarily know what was happening tonight.
They
okay.
Pull a permit?
That's a good question, not to my knowledge.
So we don't need to make a motion here, or do
well, this no, it's not a hearing, so you can take this up at any time.
You can take it up at any time. Okay.
One question.
Yes, please.
Virginia, is it historical? Will the historical commission invite a Realty Trust representative into the meeting, or is it a meeting among yourselves?
Do you know it's
an open meeting.
I know it's open, but will you invite the Realty Trust?
I will.
Yes.
Okay.
Bob.
Good. Thank you. That's it.
Okay. Unless there's anything else, we'll move on to drainage easement agreement. Seeing none, Bob.
There's a motion in your packet. There was also some information handed out tonight. Let me just find the page number. Page 4, behind the Muscarelli Field one. This issue came in front of the board, I believe it was in the middle of July, and our engineers noticed that we were abandoning too much of an easement, so we didn't want to abandon as much as had been proposed. So they got together with town council and straightened it out. So the map on page 4 is the exact easement that the applicant is actually requesting, and the town is very amenable to do. And just so you know, if the board does approve this, this will go on to the November town meeting, and it requires a town meeting approval.
So what, Bob, what's the issue? Is it just,
was it not as wide of an easement?
It initially was proposed to be the entire easement that was being abandoned, but we didn't really want to do that, and the applicant had no need for that.
Oh, okay.
So it cut back to just what the applicant, you can sort of see in very small print, those two narrow bands between Hunt Street and Lee Street.
Yep.
If you turn it upside down, you can read an area of taking, 1,500 square feet and 1,550 square feet.
Okay.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So again, the town staff engineering had certainly no objection to this whatsoever. It does not impair the town's ability to do work.
1963.
Yeah.
Okay.
6.
Halloween.
Hmm. Unless there's any comment from the public or the board?
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote pursuant to the procedures established under Mass General Law, Chapter 40, Section 15, that a portion of a certain drainage easement shown as crossing lots 43 and 44 in a plan of land entitled Easement Through Private Property for Drainage and Sewage Purposes, Lee Street, prepared by the Town of Reading, Board of Public Works, Philip Welch, Superintendent, Engineering, dated September 1963, said plan being recorded at the Middlesex South District Registry of Deeds as plan number 1513 of 1963, is no longer required for public purposes.
Second?
Second.
Further comment? All those in favor? Zero. All right, up to.
Thank you. Next is a motion to close the warrant.
Yep.
With a single ballot question as the target.
Can I raise a point of order
Sure.
for something that we haven't dealt with, and it's not really on the agenda?
Okay.
The board did not take a position article by article after we closed the warrant on the September 12th articles. Would we be out of order doing that tonight or not?
Chairman Halsey didn't suggest it, but he wouldn't be
okay.
out of order.
Also, Article 8, I've heard a couple of ways we're going to be dealing with that. Have you and Alan come to some conclusion about how that's going to be dealt with?
Alan and John and I have met, and Alan was debating his options.
Okay.
I think I know what he's going to do, but it's really up to Alan to make that call.
There was one option I heard that the reports would be given under Article 8, town meeting would adjourn, sign a die, Board of Selectmen meeting would continue.
That is definitely one option.
And discussion would happen with Alan facilitating.
That's definitely one option.
So town meeting would be free to leave if they felt that wasn't
That's right.
something they wanted to stick around for.
Yeah, there's a general bylaw, which council was surprised to learn, that forbids any of our boards from being in session during town meeting, and I'm not sure that's a wise bylaw.
But we can recess. We can
but
recess.
You can recess.
Right.
So if that's the course of action, you and any other board that wishes can meet at 7:15, adjourn at 7, I'm sorry, recess at 7:20, and then
yep.
come back at the end. So that
I
is
don't
a path forward. The moderator was trying to decide whether he's comfortable having Article 8 as a town meeting article where there is no vote. It's not a binding vote. He understands the intent of the selectmen is to provide information and transparency. And he also understood that, by the way, he chooses to run town meeting, which is certainly his choice, Article 2 is not the right place to have a discussion. That's just a report that's one directional.
Right, right.
So, you know, and then he found out that September 1st was already on the schedule, which he thought was a good idea. But obviously you saw the room full of people. There weren't
right.
a lot of town meeting members, and the courtesy was meant to be extended directly to them. So, you know, he needs to decide whether he's comfortable with it as a town meeting article or not.
Mm-hmm.
And if not, he'll make that call after seven articles have been presented and describe to the body what his choice is.
So having the discussion under an adjourned, under the aegis of an adjourned selectman's meeting handles that objection.
Right.
It's not properly a matter to be discussed under town meeting, which
yeah,
some in the body believe very firmly. Yeah.
They do, and, so. And you know, town council is a little surprised with sort of all the fuss.
Yeah.
He said, you know, other towns impeach presidents. I don't know what the big fuss is.
Jeez.
well, that may be.
Yeah.
Have they ever actually
well,
successfully
when they're not going after Citizens United?
Yes,
mean,
exactly.
I
was thinking of that.
I would have fully expected the opposite motive would have been the rule of the day, that people would have expected and anticipated the board to be as transparent and as use every opportunity
yeah.
they could. I'm just shocked that folks don't want to hear. I don't want to hear. That's
there is a small core of town meeting members that do not believe that since they have no formal role, why are they there?
Well, we'll know at 7:05 when, or 7:30, or if we can't get a quorum, I mean, they'll vote with their feet. They won't show up.
But why is that dispositive then to the overall meeting? Why is this?
Well, the town meeting was never called because of Question 8, Article 8.
Alone,
at all. It was caused
Fair
because
enough.
Of senior tax
yeah.
relief, which, if you're going to have an override, this could not wait at all. It couldn't wait to November. The legislature can't guarantee that they can pass a home rule petition to start July 1st if you had send it to them in December. So it had to be September-ish.
What is Ray's guidance in terms of having this as a...
Well, he recognizes it's really the moderator's call.
Right.
Yeah.
He doesn't understand why it wouldn't be part of a town meeting, but he does recognize that that is Alan's call.
Also, in case there are disaffected members and they walk out and the quorum disappears, town meeting would then have to adjourn, discussion would have to stop. As many people as want can leave. Those that want to stay can stay under our meetings.
Right.
Purview. No problem. I think that's the best advantage, personally. But it's
and this way, it yeah. still is a formal body of the town, so there's formal minutes and so
yeah.
forth. There's a record of it.
Yeah.
It fulfills all of what the board's objectives are, I think.
Even the same location and the
it's
same
the
people.
Same location, right. right.
Okay. It's all the
and
same,
for the,
except it's
for
different.
The 10% or whatever amount of town meeting members that are not comfortable, it's if that's what he chooses, they just leave.
Yeah.
They would anyways.
And discussion can go on for whoever wants to continue.
That's
right.
not a bad compromise.
So a town meeting adjourns after Article 7?
If that's what he
After
decides.
The reports are given on Article 8, I believe.
No, it would be after Article 7, before Article 8 is taken up.
Why won't they give the reports and then adjourn?
He said it. He wanted to make a statement after Article 7's business is complete.
Yeah, they can give the reports anytime, that's true. Very good.
So we'll adjourn, then we'll come back out of recess.
Correct.
Have a Board of Selectmen meeting, and in the same meeting with the same attendees, talk about the same stuff.
Do we need the school committee to call themselves to order, they're there?
If they wish to, you know, if they're.
Yeah, today I let the school committee and the library trustees know through their staff. You should probably post the meeting this way if this is the way it goes.
This is like a difference without a distinction.
Exactly.
More or less, but it's.
Yeah, and to the extent there's any discomfort, it seems to pretty much satisfy all the discomfort.
Okay, perfect. Threaded the needle, huh?
Sorry about the interruption, but I don't know if the board feels they want to take the position. Oh, we could do that prior to town meeting. When are we posted?
7:15? Could be 7.
Is it okay to do it now, even though we're not on the agenda?
Yeah, it's other business, you can do that.
That's all right.
Yeah, I don't see any problem with that.
I have to get my hands on all the articles.
I was gonna say, does somebody have a list of articles they could throw up on the board here?
Article 3 was the capital improvement plan.
Just call up last week's minutes on the DC.
Was it last week's?
I don't know if they're in the minutes. It just say close where they are.
The packet, call up the packet from 2 weeks ago, I got it.
Everybody have their purple book with them?
Let me pull it up here. It's out of the truck, but I'm not running out to get it.
I'll make a motion to approve the subject matter of Article 3, which is the capital improvement plan, which had a number of puts and takes on it. I think everybody's looked that over.
That's the warrant, there we go.
What's the date?
It's the 11th, right? Oh, that's the date you sent it to me, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, I don't have it on this computer.
Okay, here it is.
I have it in my desk.
Let me just get this up in front of me, Dan, give me one sec.
Sure.
Oh, wait a minute.
You've got one off the queued up there.
I think he's got it. You love those. All that liquor paperwork.
Oh my God, it's everywhere.
There's something that could really use.
There we go.
Process improvement, streamlining the application.
It is 16th Board of Selectmen meetings, but it's Paula. If you pull up Paula, she sent it to us on the 11th.
Must be getting close.
And then it's.
Oh, another one.
Okay.
And it's page.
Right, we have two.
Got it.
Starts at page 199.
199?
No, 99, sorry.
99, you're close, two more pages.
There we go.
Hey, okay.
There we go.
So 3 is the capital.
Here we go.
Yes.
May I make that motion?
Go ahead.
Please.
I did, to approve Article 3.
Before you do, if I might just point one thing out, I've been asked a couple of questions.
Yeah.
About the cemetery garage. It's in the capital plan and has been since at least last April. I'm not sure, I mean, it was in there for a number of years, but I didn't look past April. It was in as $2.5 million last April, and that's still our best guess, is $2.5 million. If a $2.5 million project is ultimately what this project becomes, by FinCom policy, that must go to the voters. That cannot be done inside the tax levy, just to lay that out there.
Okay.
So it's not listed in the capital plan as such because we don't know if there's a project yet.
But if it becomes $2.5 million.
But if it becomes a $2.5 million project, FinCom's policy, I did the math a couple of weeks ago, is something like debt service of $211,000 or more per year. And we would do this as a 5-year borrowing, maybe a 10-year. So it's well over $210,000, just so you know. Now, that doesn't mean that that's the only way it can happen, but that is the default FinCom policy. And to my knowledge so far, we have not violated that in 10 years.
Actually, didn't that become the policy after we did the elementary schools?
Yes.
Yep.
For that reason.
And depleted the capital?
Yes.
Exactly. And their operating budgets.
Killed our capital plan for years.
Okay. So I'm not sure at the time that we had imagined a $2.5 million building project because that's so small. But it was really just a rule of thumb of how much debt service crowds you out. And at the time, you know, it's a quarter of a percent of revenues. So that's 200 and something thousand right now. So I just wanted to clarify that.
If you do over 5 years, that.
Then it's $500,000 or more, so, yeah.
And we certainly wouldn't stretch out, you know, the borrowing on this just to go around that rule.
I I wouldn't generally prefer to, no.
Just remember the cemeteries are the forever business.
Yeah, exactly. We'll issue perpetual debt.
Except for cremations are getting more popular.
All right, there was a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Supporting.
Supporting Article 3. 4-0.
Move that the board support the subject matter of Article 4 regarding the increase in elderly tax exemption from $750 to $1,000.
Second.
As the board remembers, 2010, 6 years ago, we moved it up from $500 to $750.
Yep.
Based on an area survey, I think two of us were still at 500 and six others were at 750. I don't have survey data, but Victor tells me right now 1,000 is the much more common number, and was until this summer the maximum. And again, about 20 residents will be affected.
Right.
20 times $250 is the net loss of revenue to the town.
Right? What is the new max?
Excuse me?
What is the new, the new max?
Okay. I think it's 1,500, the
thank
new maximum.
You.
Yep.
Isn't this the one that's pegged to go up with CPI?
That will be the next
that's
article.
That's the next one.
Yeah,
not this one.
Further discussion?
All those in favor?
Again.
4-0.
Move to support the subject matter Article 5, which will index the previous tax relief to a CPI index.
To the maximum.
Yeah, whatever.
Up to the maximum.
Second.
I think it is at 100%, so if CPI is up or down, that's what you do. Some towns do have flexibility there. I said don't give anyone flexibility, just do it so everyone knows what it is.
Okay.
Barry seconded. Any further discussion?
No.
Second.
Barry seconded.
Barry second.
Okay, all of us in favor supporting Article 4-0.
Move to support the subject matter of Article 6, which will reduce from 8% to 4% the interest accrued on any tax referral and recovery agreement.
Did you say 12 or 4?
From 8 to 4.
I said
8 to 4.
8 to 4.
Okay.
8 to 4.
And then the 12 comes in if you pass away while in your house. The next day it jumps to 12%.
You can't touch that.
In that state law.
In arrears.
Yeah.
It doesn't actually go in arrears. I thought it had.
Oh.
Victor thought it did, but it did not.
So it starts from
day
to
day. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh.
But it accrues.
Okay.
From that day forward, yes.
From that day forward, right.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Support the article? 4-0.
Now, move to support the subject matter of Article 7, which involves the Home Rule petition for the senior tax relief, as discussed in great length at our last meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 4-0. Support Article 7. I don't think we need to take Article 8 up.
FinCom didn't.
Okay, right.
Thank you, Dan, for doing
hey,
that.
Yeah, sure. That was a good catch.
So town meeting then would adjourn after Article 7?
Sign to die.
If that's what the moderator chooses, yeah.
And those that want to stay can stay for subsequent discussion.
They're not compelled to stay.
No.
They can tell, no, but they can.
Well, they would have to take some action in Article 8 to comply with the law. Like
I'm sure that
lay
Alan
it on
has
the table.
If that's what he's going to do, I'm sure he's got
you've
some
got to at least lay it on
proposal.
The table or postpone it
yeah,
or
the
something.
Moderator declares this article to be laid on the table.
You can definitely postpone it. Laying on the table means you can bring it up.
Yeah.
Within the meeting
okay.
ends.
Lay on the table, I think, is a legitimate disposition because we can put Article 1 and 2 on the table. It's disposed
yeah,
of.
But you can bring Article 1 and 2
you
up.
Can, but you don't have to. Just well, adjourn with it on the table.
Only until adjournment, in which case it's
right,
like
it
a sign
dies.
Die.
Yeah.
And if that's what he chooses, in theory, Article 2 reports is still available, so he can't just
right.
stop the town meeting unilaterally.
He could say, is there any other business?
Right.
Okay.
So then Article 8 becomes a discussion of the Board of Selectmen.
Right.
And other boards that may hang around.
That may hang around.
Sure.
Right. That are posted. Yeah.
You have
so
a everybody clued
take
in?
A,
clued
take a
in
3-minute break
okay.
if that happens.
There you go.
You want to read a motion? 5E?
No, is that where we're at?
That's where
we're
at.
Sorry.
Close that warrant.
Need your computer.
Most important item of the evening.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close a warrant for the October 18th, 2016 special election consisting of the following question. Shall the town of Reading be allowed to assess an additional $7.5 million in real estate and personal property taxes for the purposes of general operation of the town and public schools for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2017? Yes or no?
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Yeah, just for a point of clarification, I'm gonna make it July 1 with a number one.
Oh, the number one.
Town clerk and I were talking about that today, and July 1 seems to.
Yeah, that seems better.
Make it clear, more clear.
Exactly.
Not one, little ST?
I was thinking about that, but no, just the number one.
This officially sets the election.
Second, no further discussion? All those in favor as amended? 4-0.
We'll have something for you to sign on Monday night.
Okay. On to the preview for the warrant for November subsequent town meeting.
Pack your sleeping bag, it's gonna be a long one.
This is all the zoning stuff, right?
We have 29 articles going to November town meeting.
Mamma mia.
Let's see, 1, 2, 3 days would be before Thanksgiving, and then several days could be after Thanksgiving.
Maybe have a couple turkeys there?
I'm sure there's always some turkey.
Well, let's not have pejorative comments about our town meeting members.
The first article, as is tradition, there's a few annual reports, particularly the school department and the light department. I'll check with the moderator. He had last spring indicated he wanted to give an update on the 375th. We'll see. I don't know of any other reports scheduled. There's been some discussion whether the library project, you know, should give a report. We'll just wait and see, basically. Article 3 is the typical capital plan as required by the charter. Article 4 is to dispose of some surplus. There is a need to declare a piece of DPW equipment surplus. It's junk now. We're renting for $15,000 a month a replacement piece, and we'd like to buy it in November town meeting. It had been scheduled for a year or two from now. The next four articles are a little complicated right now. I still have some things out. Article 5 is straightforward. The town meeting has done this once before. It has to do with the fact that we sold library debt in June at a premium. So technically, we have authorized too much debt and need to bring that number down. So last time it was 900 and something thousand. I forget what it is now. It's not that much. So that article stands on its own and should be done that way.
Mechanically, what happens? How do you prepay the debt back?
No, we issued, I'll say, $1 million of face value debt, and someone paid us $1.5 million.
Correct.
For it.
Right.
So technically, we still have the authorization. We only needed $1.5 million.
Correct. You
we
got
could
the premium.
Issue another half million.
Right. Okay.
But that's not clearly the intent of town meeting.
I see.
Was dollars. And then there's some housekeeping, but it all points in a direction. We have some prior debt authorized that we don't need anymore on some projects. That's just housekeeping. The next one is getting a little tricky. We still need a ruling from bond counsel. It's transferring previous debt authorization. There's about $120,000 in debt that we have borrowed for projects that we don't need anymore. And the biggest source of those funds was the high school retaining wall, if you remember that from a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
There's a surplus of almost $110,000 just on that alone out of a $500,000 project, I think. So that's good.
Yeah, that's good.
For this article, we need to transfer it to something. My intention, if we can, is to transfer to the library project, and I know we'll need a lot of discussion on that. I don't think bond counsel is going to allow that, because the library is typically a longer debt service, and we're going to transfer.
It's also
short
excluded
stuff.
Debt, isn't it?
Yeah, but I think we could. I don't think that'd be a showstopper.
Really?
The next article, Article 8, may or may not go forward depending on Article 7, but it would be to increase the size of the library project formally. And I've said this, inside to the contractor and to the project manager only 2 or 3 weeks ago, that I need to put these articles on November town meeting as placeholders in case the project is out of money.
Mm-hmm.
As I sit here today, it is not. We are not done.
Mm-hmm.
As you probably know, the last month or so of a project is the most painful time. So I don't have any forecast. Again, right now it's on budget. 2 weeks from now, 4 weeks from now, I might say we need $65,000. I don't know. I would like to have the ability to close this project out fully,
mm-hmm,
by January 1st and never go back to it, such as the high school.
I need to make a statement here that there was a time when a public project was on like a school, a large building. That project went through a voluntary site plan review, namely a noticed hearing where butters were told. I don't believe the high school did that. I know
Right.
I didn't, because I didn't get a notice.
Right.
And I don't believe the library did either. Now, why have now, wait a minute. I thought I had a staff review.
The library project formally went in front of CPDC.
They did?
Yes.
With a noticed hearing?
Yes.
Butters were invited?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that's a change from Peter and I. It's not required, and
right.
I said if we hold customers to that, we should really do it ourselves.
Right. And the concerns of the butters were noted about
yeah.
buffering from lighting and things like that.
Yeah, and presentations were made. Until you see how things are built, you can't always imagine them. But yeah,
all
we've
right.
got full minutes.
I was under the impression that there was not a full site plan review.
No, it was full. Again,
sure.
how much has changed since then?
Not just a staff review, but a fully
absolutely.
Yeah.
No, it was
okay.
full CPDC.
All right, thanks.
No, they were tortured. I remember being in part of that meeting. It was a lengthy discussion, and the room was full.
Bob, can I go back to the thing about transferring the debt?
Mm-hmm.
Can you just elaborate a little bit more on that?
Well, we've already borrowed money, and we don't need it. So we have to do something with it. And what municipal finance law lets you do is put it onto another debt project. So if we were doing a second retaining wall, that would be easy.
Yeah.
We could add $118,000 or whatever it is to the second project, and we'd have extra. Another possibility, which I've only heard from our town accountant but not from engineering, is West Street.
Mm.
West Street's not finished. I don't know if it needs money, but we could park the money there for the time being. We did that once before with West Street on something like this. So in a way, it's kind of a shell game. You keep pushing money onto projects that may need it and they may not. But we have to eventually spend it on something because we've already borrowed the money. We can't not
right.
spend it.
Right.
We go to jail.
My concern is that some people might think, well, you know, you knew all along you only needed, you know, X, but you borrowed 2X with the idea you were going to flip it to something maybe less popular.
Yeah.
When in fact, actually, we know that's not the intention, but I can see how people...
No, I wouldn't have. I'm a pessimist. I never would have come to that conclusion. But that's interesting.
But I mean, so you know,
most projects there's some like $80, $12. You know,
yeah.
they're all rounding error. The retaining wall is a bigger one. You know, that was
did
more than 20%.
Did we just not know the cost when we did it?
Yeah.
And so went out because we don't have to come back and ask for more. We'll just borrow.
So they got in good faith an estimate. They went out, asked that for that amount, put in a contingency. It just came in cheaper. You know, it's not a complex project.
Hmm.
They did a good job. They did it on time, and they saved $100,000. It doesn't happen often.
Could, since it was a school project or something related with the school, could that money be set aside for any type of payment of a litigation matter if that comes
no.
up later?
It has to be put forward to a debt issue.
Yeah.
Only, with debt. Only a debt issue.
Hmm.
Could it be high school
well,
litigation
yeah.
if we
well,
borrow?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah. I mean,
again,
it's not a lot of money.
Again, I think
you
the
know.
Problem we're going to run into with this library is there's all kinds of limits on how far you can borrow on different kinds of projects. A retaining wall is probably either 5 or 10 years. A building is 20 or 30 years.
We did the library as 20, right?
We did it as 10.
10.
I did a really short one. So by law, by state law, you're not allowed to transfer a shorter maturity legal issue
mm-hmm.
to a longer one.
Mm-hmm.
I personally don't know why. But that's so you don't play games.
Yeah.
You know, we'd be transferring it and using it right away.
Like a former.
Right. I mean, you're
but
prepaying it.
Yeah.
So.
But some people could abuse the system
right.
much as the way you
I could see.
Described.
Yeah, I could see how an abuse could be
yeah.
made out of that.
So my guess is bond counsel is going to say you can't put that in the library project, which is fine. We'll have to find some other use for it.
Okay.
And before you close the warrant, I'll have that answer. And so you might see West Street instead of the library
yeah.
in there, for instance. And if
and West
if
Street is a longer...
And we don't have to do this now at all. It can wait. You know, it's just Sharon likes to clean things up as quickly as possible.
What's the obligation on West Street, the duration?
I haven't heard of any shortfall of money, so
that's
if
not
we were,
an issue.
If we were going to put money on West Street right now, I'd want to know why.
How about Salem Street? Did that get brought in under
budget? As far as I know, yeah.
Is that not a candidate?
No, West Street was the only one, and that's because there were a couple of engineering costs that we hadn't
yeah.
expected that were a little higher, but I still think net-net it worked out, but again,
yeah.
I don't know.
Well-managed project, by the way.
Yeah, West Street.
Terms of closing traffic as little as possible.
It's tricky to drive over.
Although some of the West Street neighbors might.
Yes.
Bob, as we sit here tonight, what's the forecast completion date of the library?
There's a grand opening on first weekend in October, and that's the forecast.
Okay.
Now, I think late September is still the goal, but I was over there this morning for a couple hours. Compared to 2 weeks ago, it was much better than it was. It's amazing how much can happen in a couple of weeks. And it's pretty much all optics. It's not really construction, obviously, but it's just, you know, cleaning. There's a lot of cleaning that has to go on. You've had a building under construction for a year and a half.
Yeah.
There's some final mill work to be done, not as part of the building, but as part of standalone furniture.
The shelving.
And the shelving is all going in. Some of it's in today. It'll go in for the next couple of weeks. A lot of technology has to come in. So it's in pretty good shape. But pretty good shape is not complete. You know, it's
still.
Can't
open the doors for business.
No, you can't let the public in yet. Again, that should happen the first week of October, last week of September. So really, this is just a placeholder in case the project does need money. Because if it does, I want to stand up in front of town meeting and explain why and wrap the thing up.
Right.
Just be done with it.
So just one more question, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
The problem that we had before where we had, where town meeting authorized us to for debt, but we couldn't, but the projects came in way overbid.
The Birch Meadow lighting, for instance?
Well, Birch Meadow lighting, but also I'm thinking there was something with Killam.
Yep.
There was a Killam field.
Oh, the field.
Yeah,
a year ago.
There was
yep.
a couple of other ones where basically the bids were so high.
Yeah, there was a water one.
Water one. So that debt can't be used?
We never sold the debt.
Oh, okay, so the authorized, but we never sold it.
Right.
This is money, that debt that we
sold.
Sold,
yeah.
That we're paying on
right.
because we sold it. But
right. That's why we're under an obligation to do something with the money.
Right.
Right. And once you transfer it in the manner you described, it loses its identity as the former project. It's just wrapped up in the new one.
Yes. Legally, yeah. And if you did it again,
so
same
forth,
thing.
So on.
I mean, it's impossible to get it exactly right ever.
Ever.
Because you could know.
It's a shell game, a little bit of a shell game.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, one of them literally is $12.08 out of a couple million.
I mean, that's great that you can get it that close.
Amend the budget. It's an annual thing in November. I have no idea what we have other than capital. We'll see. We do have some prior year bills. Sharon will give you more of a report. At one point, some of them went back, I think, to the 1960s. There's some really bizarre ones.
You're
in
kidding.
There. Well, not quite that far, but there was something to do with the MBTA that has been forgetting to invoice us, so we haven't paid, and none of us have any idea what they're talking about. But, you know, with the MBTA and the financial straits there are, they're uncovering a lot
find
of
every
rocks. Yeah. So once they really tell us what they want, then we'll analyze it and we'll figure it out, but none of us have ever heard what they're talking about.
Do we know the magnitude?
It's a small, like a $1,200 a year times a few years or something
cool.
like that. So it's not a lot.
The bill's made out in a quill pen.
The retirement board has requested to put an article on that I'm not all that familiar with, but retirees do have a certain cost of living adjustment and they want to increase it by, I think, 0.5%. So they'll explain that, and the article as it's written will explain that. There's your drainage easement that you agreed with tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Town council has said that past town meeting did not fully and properly dispose of the Oakland Road matter. And I told him, let's just start from scratch, pretend they did nothing, do it the right way, and he said fine. So I forget the exact wording, but town meeting abandoned either public or private roads. They should have just abandoned roads.
Yeah.
What's the difference whether it's public or private, these paper streets?
Mm-hmm.
So that first one is really simple. It's what town meeting should have done years ago. And the second one is to authorize the board to sell.
Finally. Yep.
And I believe before before this comes in front of town meeting, again, I do have someone that's an interested buyer potentially. I'd like to bring them in before November town meeting,
yeah,
just
absolutely.
So you get a flavor.
Absolutely.
It doesn't mean we can just sell it to them. You have to go through the process,
right,
and they
right.
will understand that. It's an excellent use, though. I really can't say
I mean,
it's really good.
What's our ability to sort of direct? I mean, obviously, it doesn't have to necessarily go to the highest bidder. Could it be a use that the board prefers?
Yeah,
over
you have
use?
Some ability, but not free hand, but you have some ability.
We have guidelines? Do we have?
Yes, absolutely. Town council is going to help you go right through. know.
When's the last time
you steer it? Not in so many words.
Well, I mean, if there's a public purpose that, you know, fits a lot of the things that we've been talking about, but maybe it doesn't have, maybe it's not the highest bid, but, or is it, does it have to be the highest bid?
Yeah, there are criteria that have to be met, whatever they are. Now,
What's it zoned? I mean, you could.
That's what I was gonna say. Ultimately, it's whatever it's zoned.
Right.
Now, if the new use wants to ask for a new zoning, then that would have to also go to town meeting.
Right.
So any sale would be contingent on underlying zone.
There are limits to zoning and restrictions.
Yes.
We can't.
I don't know if you can limit on use. You know, that's one of those Dover Amendment things.
Right.
I don't know. I don't wanna say that you can't.
But within those two, you take the highest bidder. Within, everyone in that class.
Yes, but the two could really be eight conditions. You know, you have to fill these eight conditions.
You could restrict it so tightly.
Right. Yeah.
It's not so much we wanna keep something out, it's we wanna encourage something positive to come in. That's a difference. I mean, the Dover Amendment was to prevent you from sort of restricting it.
Right.
Here, if we're trying to promote certain uses, that's different.
Is there a way to do a request for, or a request for proposals?
That's the way we do it, is an RFP, absolutely. So you might get, depending on how broadly you word it, you might get all nature of things, but my guess is you're gonna wanna channel it to some degree.
Right.
You know, is it housing? Is it residential housing? Is it something else? We'll go through that.
Yep, all right.
I would just caution the board to recall that our new growth figures lag considerably behind those of our peer communities.
This is one of the larger pieces of small amounts of real estate.
Probably the biggest piece we have left, so don't totally disregard.
Absolutely.
The bottom line when we look.
And just to be clear, I will not be proposing we build a DPW garage. Just put that one right out there.
That's going nowhere.
Has been some suggestions.
Selectmen, I might have a slight objection.
DOA.
Then we have a couple of general bylaws, and then we'll get to zoning bylaws. The first one allows the town clerk to make quote-unquote non-substantive corrections.
The bylaw.
This is a fairly simple one. Which means it'll get 2 hours of discussion.
Yes.
The next one is a new requirement, as some of these are. It's to authorize revolving funds, and town council will explain that. The next three, I think, or two of them at least, have to do with stormwater. The first one is a general bylaw that's created by new federal legislation that just came out in the spring. And we'll be one of the first towns that has implemented this. All of them will have to. The next one, Article 18, is an interesting byproduct of the charter. We abolished the DPW in the charter. Ray figures we may as well put them back as a general bylaw. As right now they don't really have solid legal standing, and this will just give them solid legal standing. You know, and this is one of the things I know the bylaw committee had on its list of repairs to make as needed to the charter changes.
Mm-hmm.
19 is something that council suggested last winter when we started. If you remember, we went to town meeting and had some private ways made public. And I told him what our practices were, and he said, you really should have a bylaw that allows you to make repairs on a private way for public safety.
Mm-hmm.
We just do it. He said, you really should have a bylaw that
given
allows
that
you to.
Given that we plow it for public safety.
We plow it, and we make minor
up.
Repairs so that we can plow it and get an ambulance
right.
in there.
Yeah.
And he said, you really just ought to have a bylaw that says you can do that.
And the reason is somebody could restrict you.
In theory. If something went wrong, somebody
or
could
the work
say,
wouldn't get
what
done.
Right did you have
yeah.
to be here? So even though you're saving my life. The next one is something he suggested that really should have come along with the stormwater enterprise fund, just a bylaw that goes hand in hand with it. He said most communities do the bylaw first and then actually create the fund, and I said, well, we just happen to
have the
fund first. So this is catch up, I guess. 21 is the last new bylaw that's related to some new federal regulations on drainage. So there's a lot of commonality in some of these bylaws. A lot of them are stormwater related.
We'll have these bylaws written by then?
Oh yeah, they're already written, all but one of them. And then the zoning bylaws, I believe they're all written. I haven't looked. The first one, I'm a little less familiar with these. The first one effectively is to clarify some of the powers of the CPDC,
mm-hmm.
a bylaw. The next one, and a lot of this is spun off of the former zoning changes, that's the ZA under the ZAC at town meeting,
mm-hmm.
Where through practice, staff and CPDC has come into some rocky road and said, you know, we hadn't really anticipated this, let's clarify it. Next one would qualify as that, some site plan review, change in language. The next one is the same idea, pet grooming. That was not as clear as it might have been. Special home occupation, I don't know anything about that, other than it's also a byproduct of zoning changes.
Is it restricting or making less restrictive the ability to have one?
I think it's clarifying, honestly, Dan. I don't know. I don't think it's making it more restrictive.
Right.
I think it's clarifying it. It may loosen it up a bit. Accessory apartments is also, that's fine. It's just a clarification.
Mm-hmm.
Same with accessory or building structures. The next two are changes. I think there's been some unexpected consequences of the lot shape bylaw that we used, and they'll have to get into explaining why they need to change that.
This could take four meetings, five
it'll
meetings.
Be Christmas.
This is at least going to take four.
Every one of these zoning bylaws could be a 2-hour discussion.
Yeah. Okay. And the last one, but not the least, is the sign bylaw.
Right, which that has to go.
Now, what CPDC decided to do this summer was to make as few changes as possible, but just make it constitutional. So that's the attempt of this article.
But once you open it up, you get every, that just...
And the intent is for a year from November, that's when the changes are gonna happen.
Yeah.
But as we all know, you change three words and you can have unintended consequences, you could certainly have an open discussion.
I'm sorry, the vote this year...
This year it is just simply to take the current signed bylaw, which is not constitutional.
And make it constitutional.
Make it constitutional. And make it not contradict itself.
Mm-hmm. And next year, what will happen?
And then next year, in November,
mm-hmm.
to start discussing in March any proposed changes for 6 months.
All right. That's
let
a big
everyone
one.
Have at it and make changes.
All right.
Bob, I know Ray wants to clean a lot of this stuff up, and each one on its face makes sense to kind of do and clean up. But I mean, at a certain point, does the center hold? I mean, you know, can some of these get pushed out? Can some of the, I mean, obviously, we want to deal with any of the, you know, obviously, like the sign one, because right now it's unconstitutional. But, you know, can we take 6 or 7 out and delay them just to?
You absolutely could, but the problem is CPDC and staff has run into practical issues in interpreting the current bylaws, and it's causing the building inspector one of these moments.
What do I do?
And honestly, most of those, from what I understand, I know you can drive a truck through any of them, but most of them are not complex. It's like we found this little niche, we want to fix this little niche, simply. It doesn't usually work that way in town meeting floor, but that's the thought.
Yes.
This is nowhere like zoning reform was 2 years ago. Not
right.
at all. Not even close.
Yeah. I mean, it feels like it, though.
Because of the size, the number of articles.
I think when you break it down, it doesn't look that complex to me. Yeah.
No, there's none of them there. Again, I don't know the special home occupation as well. I don't think any of them are complex. I think they're really simple. A lot of them are definitions and a couple words.
Barry's raising a good point. I wonder, given the repetition of the theme zoning bylaw, and given that these are clarifications, is there, I don't want to create more work, is there a format we could use that creates consistency and therefore speed in going through these?
Well, we had talked about grouping them and not laying them out as individuals and decided it was too confusing, because if you had one article with 5 pieces to it, why is that an advantage?
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking more, is there a standard way to template each of the articles that talks about a change?
Oh, sure, certainly.
It appears exactly the same way in each
yes.
case.
Yes.
So that people get used to the format and we don't argue about that.
No, that's a good idea. That's in the presentation, absolutely, in the background.
These 5 just deal with minor clarifications.
Right.
This one's a little bit more either or, more substantive.
You remember that huge translation guide that Jesse and Gene worked on? You know, if you happen to read the first few pages, it did just that. It summarized. It said, these are the kinds of things that are, you know, small typographical changes. These are the ones that are changed because of legal reasons. These are the ones that are changing intent.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think a lot of people spent a lot of time reading through all that. There was just so much. The volume was so huge. That's a good idea.
My desired outcome would be that every one of these feels very familiar, even though the subject matter may be different. Just optically, it looks the same.
And the key to that is a good write-up in the description. With a good, I always like to have a starting one before a section of things.
Yes.
So even for the general bylaws, I'd put in a couple paragraphs. General bylaw changes that follow into these categories. Same with zoning.
Mm-hmm.
We've done that in the past. I don't know if it helps town meeting, but it seemed better to me. So this has got to be at least a past Thanksgiving four-night town meeting. I think we've asked for six nights at the Fieldhouse or at the Performing Arts Center.
I can see four.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I could even see three, one of the best of all.
Those are sponsored by CPDC.
Yes.
So the other thought might be to have the same speaker up. I know this is going to be a burden, but have one person speak to all of them.
I think that's their intention.
Jeff, probably.
Yeah, I think Jeff.
He's very good.
All right.
Excellent.
On to fiscal year 17 goals and running 2020 updates.
Okay.
Make that bigger for the benefit.
Very small print.
Oh.
Do you have that?
It's even small for me.
There we go.
So if, as the board will recall, there's five groups of 2020 groups, and there's five goals each, five by five. The first is financial sustainability. I won't read the groups. You can see the names behind me. The first goal, I believe, is complete. You know, financial review going forward through a couple of different scenarios. I think we've all probably done as much of that as we ever wanted to. The second is local real estate tax policy, which I also believe is complete. That doesn't mean the town meeting may not make amendments. That's fine, but I think we've all done our background and base work. Projects outside the tax levy. I'm saying that's half done. I haven't really gone into a lot of detail on Killam because right now we don't know any, but the state has evaluated Killam. They owe us an answer this fall as to where Killam ranks on the goodness and badness scale. And it surprised me the last time the state came up with a ranking that it was very low in terms of needing repairs. It was not an urgent repair at all. It was, I think, a category two when a five gets you immediate repairs. The thinking locally is that'll probably change. And if it does, it moves us much closer to MSBA reimbursement. And as you know, that's a long process. So if there is to ever be, and there will be someday, some kind of a repair or change to Killam, this is where it would start, is the state declaring that it is now 3 years away from being reimbursable, or something like that, that it's higher up on the list. We were nowhere near the list last time this year. So that we should know, if not by November town meeting, certainly by April. And then the other is the TPW garage and slash cemetery garage. I don't know of any other building project that would qualify outside the levy at all.
I noticed the comment about adding the floor to Killam potentially. Is that to accommodate future all day K, pre-K?
Unknown. We've just discussed it with the superintendent and facilities director and I, or different subgroups of those, that if Killam is going to take a major repair, or we ought to look at it from a space needs standpoint.
Absolutely.
List all your space needs, and John's obviously very interested in doing that. Whether it's all-day kindergarten, whether it's bringing more special ed in district, whatever it is. Because if you're, this, it's your last elementary school, as long as you're sticking a five.
More bang for the buck to add it to an existing school than build a whole new school.
Right, and if, just, I'm just talking completely out of my hat now, if the goal is to do all-day kindergarten in the local schools, you build Killam large enough to redistrict that. Yeah. So, to allow, and that's what the community said 10 years ago wanted when Wood End was built, is neighborhood schools including kindergarten.
But never move the lines.
Well, that's a school committee.
I know.
You can move the schools, but just
it's tough.
Just don't move my kid.
Yeah.
Gather feedback from the community. We did that in the spring and during the summer, and I suppose we'll continue to do that. The thing that always strikes me is that there's obviously two sides of opinions, but never has anyone that does not want an override ever come forth and suggest what we could stop doing, ever.
Yeah.
I'd be thrilled to have that suggestion. And then, short of us still working on our website, we've given the public too much information in some ways. We're now condensing it to visually very abbreviated formats, so that someone that doesn't have 20 minutes to sit down and read 8 pages of documents, they can just go and look at one or two charts, one or two visual aids, and understand the summary. We've got some good staff work on that that will be done probably by next Monday. So the financial group is in relatively good shape. It's almost done. The next one, through Sharon, operational efficiency. That's a work in progress, as some of you know. Sharon is still trying to close the fiscal year, and it's September. Our former town accountant came to visit her today, and I said, go scold her. But in fairness, the schools have been without a business manager for quite some time, and Sharon has been doing that job in a lot of ways. So she's been carrying a heavy load this summer. It's not been a off.
New person is on board, though. Right?
She started a week or two ago. I have not yet
started the school committee.
Okay.
So it should be a combination business finance manager?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, tonight was a good example. Regionalization works well, but organizations and towns don't behave the same. So North Reading doesn't work the same way as Reading. You know, it's dangerous to assume certain communication patterns
mm-hmm.
when just because that's the way we do it. Maybe that's not the way someone else does it. And we know North Reading pretty well, but you know, it does always harken back that it's not you doing it. When you're sharing it with someone else, when you're doing it with another town, it's hard for it to be more efficient. Let's put it that way. It could save money. It's only more efficient if it provides you access to a resource you don't have in your town, like a lake. We try to get recreation to regionalize with Wakefield because we wanted their lake, and they finally saw through that and said, no, cut it out. We weren't going to save any money. We just could expand the offerings to our residents and honestly theirs. You know, we have a lot more turf fields. So, you know, regionalization is not necessarily all it's cracked up to be, but there certainly is a place for it. And Victor's a great example. I mean, you know, we couldn't ask for a better result than assessing certainly. There is a master plan for human elder services in process now. I believe that contract's been signed. So we'll have a result sometime in the winter in time for the budget process, certainly. You know, we'll see how much we can afford to do, certainly. The whole of staff have been trying to focus a little more on operations data. You started to see more of that in the warrant book last spring. We'll continue to try to improve that. It's a long process where you have to start first gathering data before it can make any sense. So we did start that a couple of years ago. Municipal data is not easy to gather. It's easy to gather. It's very hard to compare to other towns because they gather it differently. Peer comparisons, you saw as many of those as you'd want to see in the finance world. Well, we'll bring them in on a smaller scale. Jesse Wilson is working on a project for the economic development mm-hmm. where she's doing 25 community peer surveys, including site visits. And I'll bring her into you at some point. You'll be really interested. And I'll be interested in what she learns, certainly. And then technology is an ongoing thing, really. I believe we are going to change, for instance, our mass communication tool this fall from Everbridge to Code Red after a lot of group work and research with other towns. So that should happen in the next 60 days. Communication under Matt. So your liquor policy is under review right now, as are some of your other policies. Article 2 appointed boards, Matt and staff and council have actually had some discussions. I don't think that full group has met yet, but I know he intends to do that right after September town meeting. So the first thing you will see is a recommendation on alcohol, because that's really got a December 1st hard deadline. You know, some of these policies, honestly, were established 25 years or more ago.
And it's interesting just to see the whole plastic cup thing, just because.
Right. Well, then it's a good thing Paula knew the reason.
Because, you know, the glass gets the good housekeeping seal of approval.
Improving communication between boards and the selectmen and the community, you know, that's a multi-directional street.
It's a lot of communication.
Quite often we have single points of contact and thus failure at the staff level with a number of our boards. For historic, for Virginia, we have no staff. I mean, she's administratively in community and public services under Jean, but we don't provide any staffing for her meetings. So we keep up as we can. You know, and it's not a model that's in balance. We have so much volunteer government. We don't have the resources to support them. It's just simple. You know, and the board will eventually wrestle with that balance and say, do we need more resources to support them, or do we need less volunteers, or both?
Take it right now.
You know, I don't know the answer. Matt has cable negotiations in his wheelhouse. I know he's talked to some law firms. You'll get an update on that also early part of the winter. That's 2 years from November. website has actually had a lot of improvements. The problem with the town's website is there's too much stuff there.
There's way too much stuff.
Yeah, and we know that, but we're not sure what to get rid of or how to streamline it.
Like the budget, nobody wants to give it up.
Yeah, it is hard. We look at other towns and see what they do, and I don't remember a town, I'd say it if I remembered, but some of them are really good, but the volume they have is much less, and maybe that's why it's really good. You know, how much detail do you really need? And then the library building project, you know, it's trucking along as best it can. For policy, you saw a whole lot of general bylaws and zoning bylaws in front of you. You know, I should update that because now he's got more than three. That's probably 75% complete, and it'll be fully done after November town meeting. Selectmen's policies, I'm not sure that there is, you have five or six policies. We started with what I think is the most important one, and then we'll branch off into Articles 1 and 3, which are operating procedures and licenses. My guess is you're going to look at some of that stuff and scratch your head and say, why do we do this? And, you know, unless Paula knows, I won't. Goal 19, I've talked to our former HR administrator, and I've talked to our three department heads that have unions, and I've talked to our labor council, and collectively those five are going to put their heads together and make sure that our union contracts are fully legal, which we believe they are, but no one's ever looked at them stem to stern, just looked at issues one at a time. And then try to organize them or streamline them, much as you were saying for the town meeting articles. I have a template I worked out for the firefighters last time through that I think would apply to all the unions. We'll just see how that goes. But really, you know, one of the things we've all learned in the last year or two is there is a price to be paid for not spending money on legal advice. Some of it is you can't sleep at night as well. So I just feel like we spend last year on labor, I don't even know if we cracked 10 grand. It was an astonishingly low number, and that's good because we have good labor relations. We're going into collective bargaining this winter, so every 3 years with collective bargaining, we normally spend a little more. But we do not have labor council at the bargaining table ever. We're a very unusual town in that regard. Most of our unions do not have their legal counsel at the table, most. One or two occasionally do. We just have
and when
good,
they
good
do, relationship. Do we automatically bring ours in?
No, we don't. We never have. In my 10 years, we've never brought labor council to a bargaining session.
It changes the tenor.
We've talked to him
when
in
they
between.
Bring, even when, really, okay.
No. You know, we'll obviously listen to something and say, okay, we can't react to that right now. We'll get back to you. But
I would imagine that changes the tenor of the whole conversation as well.
You know, we've had union reps as opposed to lawyers in the room for the other side. And honestly, as soon as they leave the room, we solve the problem.
Right.
Just
I'm exactly correct.
Yeah.
What's the scope of this retired HR administrator? What would you expect that to be in terms of?
She'll finish the work by December. I don't think it's a lot of work on her part, actually. She's worried it's not enough, and why are we even bothering her? Okay. I said, because you're a resource. You'll know why we did something 7 or 10 years ago, and none of us will. Personnel policies, our current HR director is reviewing that. There's been this committee that's met for some period of time, I don't know, 1 or 2 years. She gave me a briefing during the summer of some changes, and I kept saying, no, we're not going to do that. But you know, we'll find out what employees want. And it's really hard to categorize even. There's not a lot of suggested changes so far, but I guess the key would be flexibility. Don't try to have one rule that fits us all, and I agree with that.
Yeah.
So just as an example, you know, every job and every amount of time in the job has a default vacation period. Every job's like that. Maybe not every employee in those circumstances want the same amount of vacation time. So one idea is that you have, he's trying to get the bagpipes.
Pause button. The pause is right in the middle of the screen. Just
You know, you could have two employees doing the exact same job. One prefers time off, one prefers pay.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe if the town could be flexible, you'd have two happy employees. You know, we'll see how that all works
out. Also, too, Bob, as the composition of the workforce changes,
yeah,
a lot of what folks find meaningful will change. I mean,
yeah. I have friends in other businesses that have a lot younger employees than the town does, for instance. and they say, you know, hiring people is interesting, retaining them is much more interesting. he said it's impossible to describe, other than you'll feel like a school teacher, you'll feel like a kindergarten teacher.
Yeah.
The employees want to be praised, they want to be thanked. I was like, well, that could be quite a stress for me.
No participation trophies in the workplace, though.
And lots of group work, no one's wrong. It's like, okay, well, we'll see, bring it on. Last group's planning, and I know, Barry, you've joined the staff at one of the meetings. There's a lot of things going on here. It's hard to capture, but you know, downtown, we have a meeting with CPDC scheduled. Over the last week, I met with a really interesting, I guess, economic development person last Thursday, who more or less helped put Lowell and Lawrence on the map with some of their mill work.
Hmm.
And after listening to him, I'm going to delay your October 4th joint meeting with CPDC. I don't think we're ready. I think we need to all step back at the staff level and really ask ourselves a lot of questions and set up that meeting better. We're going to ask a handful of local developers. I shouldn't mention who, but I said to him, so would so-and-so want to come to a meeting like this, who's a big developer up in Lowell? He said, absolutely, he would love to come to a meeting like this. I said, okay, hold on. We want to be real careful who we invite and just get some real important sort of players in the room. And it's also going to be important for the board, as CPDC's appointing authority, to give them more direction. You know, you saw some of that. First of all, the joint meetings you had have been excellent, I think. Remember the one at Parker, I thought was really good.
Yep.
But they have indicated to you a couple times they're looking for direction. We didn't want to do this without direction from the board. From my layman's standpoint, some of that direction should be, you have to be so detail-oriented, and that's completely my personal opinion. But applicant after applicant comes through after talking to CPDC, and they just can't believe the extent of detail that they have to go into with that body. So, you know, maybe a little chat with them on, do you really have to do all that? Does it really matter that the sign is 2 inches longer than, you know, you said it could be? I think just from a practical standpoint, you know, the town has occasionally in the past certainly got a reputation on being business unfriendly. No one has ever pointed the finger at CPDC, I'm doing that. I think they're part of that issue. It's not just, mm-hmm. you know, conservation or folks like that. I think they're interest in detail is excruciating, and I'm clearly on the opposite side of that, so you have to hear them, you know, and I'd ask you to hear them. There's other priority development areas. I was on the, or is it rather in a meeting with two fellows this morning that you may want to help us out with one of them. I'll work with John Halsey on that one. Oakland Road could also be a nice outcome for this one.
Is that another opportunity for regionalization in your mind? Some of the
which one?
The economic development candidate, perhaps.
Well, that's a really hard question. As soon as Jessie finishes, she's got a questionnaire, a survey electronically. She just told me there's 55 questions. I said, man, we might want to streamline
yeah.
that a bit.
Yeah.
But it flows really, really well. I have to then pitch it to 25 town managers and administrators and say, we want you to participate, mm-hmm. not you personally, but probably your staff, by answering these questions and by allowing us to visit. So there has to be a reason why they're going to want to do this. So there has to be a hook. And the usual hook
yeah.
is I'll share the data with
yeah.
you.
Right.
So I'll show you the survey. It's pretty compelling. If we all knew what the answers were in this, we'd feel a lot better about understanding economic development as a group. And generally speaking, economic development is not competitive. You know, if we do something, North Reading can do the same thing, and we both win. It's not necessarily a zero-sum game. So I do think we should have more discussions about this regionally. Generally, we're familiar with North Reading and Wakefield, to a lesser degree, Woburn, just because of form of government. And Stoneham historically hasn't done much, but they have hired a planner in the last year, so they're doing more. So we're generally aware, but we don't necessarily do a lot together, I guess I'll say. The planners do, to be fair. They do a good job, but the town leaders don't do economic development planning. Maybe the survey is a tool to do that.
Although the position that we envisioned is really more of a Reading advocate.
Yes, absolutely.
So I wouldn't want to see us regionalize that position per se.
Right.
Although there obviously is benefit in having regional development in some ways, but
yeah.
I think our view of that was to sort
so
of be the cheerleader kind of.
The fellow
slash.
That came in told a story you'll enjoy. I'll tell it quickly. but it's so different than any interest or skill set that any of the employees in Reading have with me right at the front. He said, so I was working for the Chamber of Commerce up there at the time, and there was a medical company that I wanted to get into a mill as the chief tenant. So we redid one of the floors a little bit. We got a couple of chefs up there, beautiful food, gourmet tables. At the end, beautiful picture window, picked a beautiful moonlit night. I walked the CEO up there. He smelled all the food. I said, and this view will be yours. He signed that day. Do you envision any of us doing something like that? There's no way.
Well, I think to Barry's point,
we need a moonlit view of a river.
Yeah.
Good point. Could visualize something like that.
Yeah.
You know what? You know, how could you work for two entities side by side?
No, my thought is different. It comes down to whether it's top down or bottom up. If it's bottom up and you're trying to pitch Reading,
yeah,
you're like this. I got Reading and I got blinders on. If I'm trying to pitch a concept and you've got a view of what the other towns are doing, you've got some sense of the synergy or what fits or what works or what doesn't work.
Yeah. If you're gonna put in this, then this would complement that over here. That's
right. I mean, one guy's selling only what you have, the other guy's saying, right, what does the other guy not have and how do I play off that? Mm. It's more that thought.
Using it to competition as a good thing. You know?
Yeah, yeah. How do we not duplicate what the other guy has done?
Right.
Because you just divide
play off it,
yeah,
so both of them do better.
I don't know.
There's gonna be a couple meetings during the winter. The board's gonna have a lot of chance to give us opinions on things like that. I mean, I'd be interested to know what your collective opinions are of what Reading is, or what Reading could be, and that's a really open-ended question.
How long are you?
That's the problem. Exactly. So we'll have to structure it somehow.
Yeah.
The last couple things, infrastructures, is fairly vanilla. You know, we'll get to that more after the September town meeting. And then town-owned land, Oakland Road, is obviously front and center. We should have that wrapped up by November. And, you know, potentially that piece of, you know, if the party I'm talking to is really interested, that could be wrapped up early next year, early next calendar year. So we'll see. So that's an overview of the goals. Considering we're 2.5 months into the year, it's not bad. And obviously the first one has dominated all the financial stuff.
Right. All right. Then we have discuss town manager performance evaluation process.
This is something that's been in your packet before, and I've discussed largely with John Halsey. This is the employee performance review that every town staff member goes through with one union's exception. And it was not easy to design a form. If you think of the type of employees and jobs we have, not easy to design one
form.
So is it perfect? Of course it's not. So there's a little bit of a flavor as to why we're doing this and what's going on. Part one is a list of objectives. So for instance, we can cut and paste those 25 goals you just had, which would be a few more than most people get.
Right.
Then there's competency areas. There's 11 by default, and as a manager, I would have 4 more, in theory, customized in here, and then you just rank on each. And for our non-union employees, if they get 1 below standard, they don't get a step. Some of our unions have different rules on that. But generally speaking, a below standard grade in any of these 15 is really bad news. And it's not something that should ever be a surprise to any employee. It's something that would have been discussed for quite a while. And then if that happens, there has to be a reason listed down here in detail.
Do you have to call out exceptional exceeds also?
It's a style question for whoever's doing the evaluation. I don't tend to go right up the middle here and say meet standards for everything. I tend to use a fair amount of exceed standards for people.
But what I'm saying is, because you have to make a comment for below.
You don't have to. You can't. Okay. Most people don't. It's a defensive kind of a tool.
Yeah.
Back on the does not meet.
Yeah.
You're doing corrective action plans, I assume.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yes. Very much so. And some of those involve, instead of waiting a year to review, you're going to come in 3 months.
Right. Every quarter.
Every 3 months. Yeah. This is a more of a personal development plan. What types of support could the town give you to develop professionally?
Mm-hmm.
Usually in your current job, but potentially for a promotion or a different job. You know, we do understand that to a degree. And then future objectives would be, for instance, the board's next 25 after the last 25 have been disposed of. Usually we tend to have 5 to 10 for most employees. And then part 5 I use extensively. This is where I can put in what people have done well or not so well. I usually have a page or two of comments. Some of our supervisors just have a paragraph or two. And then most of our employees don't say anything, but some of them actually put in some pretty thoughtful comments here, and then we both just sign.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a clear explanation of what all those things you were ranked on is,
good.
So there can be not a huge amount of misunderstanding.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the form. It's simple. From the way the past board has evaluated Peter and the current board has evaluated me, I think this takes care of a lot of what you want. And I think to the extent you find it's not enough, you can find a way to add to this,
sure.
with whatever's missing. And that may have to evolve over time.
It's amazing you got into 4 or 5 pages. That's really hard to do.
I want you filled out, it takes more of it.
Yeah,
right. Yeah,
I was going
to
say.
But it's rarely more than 8 to 10.
Yeah.
Very rare. And that's part of the key, is think in a concise way.
Yeah.
You know, we need to communicate. And again, the review, everyone's different how they review people. I read them all. I read every single one that is done on the town side. It takes a while. And it's really interesting. The styles of managers can be very different one to the next, within a department even. But you learn a lot. We also had this form called a 3-2-1 form that was voluntary for employees.
Yes.
I don't remember the categories, but the one was, what would you do if you were running the town differently? And the suggestions we got were really interesting. We've done a lot of those things. So, you know, your employees are a really good resource if you use them.
Or the suggestion box.
Yeah.
This appears not to be geared toward a GPA-type metric evaluation.
True. You could turn it into that, but it isn't.
Unless
so
you're going to do something with the number.
For instance, the superintendent's evaluation was very much quantitative. You've done one for me in the past that
right.
was. You know, we can work on that together. I don't mind one way or the other.
Not hard bend on it. But
yeah.
The one... the one actually we use at the bank, I think is one of the best ones I've seen in my working career, in that essentially you as the employee sort of rate yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not just, you know, 1s, 2s, and 3s, but like really specific questions. You set a list of goals in which when you have to go back at the end of the year, it's on your screen, these were your goals. What went well, what did you do, what did you miss, how could we have helped you? And it was very iterative. And it was really at the end that the manager just sort of reviews your own self-assessment. And when there's disagreement, you sit down and do it. But it's more on the employee than the employer.
Well, I should hasten to add, it's a style question, but I always have people I'm reviewing fill theirs out first. And then I change it if I wish, and I usually do. But in large measure, they know what they're doing well or not doing well and why.
The thing is, they may not know what they're doing well.
No, sometimes there's a little bit of a surprise, and that's happened over 10 years. But I think it's really important that, in my case, I think it's really important you tell me to fill that out. Why should you do all that work, for one
right.
thing? You don't know, especially, you don't know. But I don't know a lot of what our individual employees are doing either. How could I fill it out from scratch? But if they
have 25 goals, I mean,
yeah, so you have a better
ranked
idea
against that, because those are collectively we all agree that this is what we're going to do and that's important. And did we accomplish that? But then there's more nuanced things.
But the goals don't line up necessarily to those evaluation areas.
Yeah, your process is an interesting process, but when you add in 5 heads now,
right?
You're doing it. It almost changes. You almost want to have Bob fill it out, seal it in an envelope. Now you guys go fill it out. Let's open the envelopes all at the same time.
Yeah, that would be interesting. I don't usually ask employees to fill out part 2, but I do ask them to fill out the rest, because what's the difference, really?
Yeah.
But I'll just throw that out there as one tool.
Okay.
You should get together as a group and review me at some point in the next couple of months.
That's what I was just about to ask you. I know getting it earlier has always been helpful for you, so.
Yeah, and the summer was not a summer, so.
No, it was not.
Throw out all the molds.
Well, when did we do the last one?
We did in the summer. We had it done by August.
Was it?
We had it done before, so I'm pretty sure we had it in August.
I don't honestly
when
remember.
I first got on the board, it was like April, you were finishing it up.
One of the, it used to be, wasn't Peter done like in January or February or something? And that didn't really make sense, because all our employees are fiscal year and he is calendar year.
Right. No.
And so I changed it to fiscal year. I said, we're always 6 months off with the rest of the organization. I don't honestly remember. We may have done it in July or August, but I think I remember once in October. So,
Yeah, I think
it's not like we don't talk all the time.
Yeah.
So
Shouldn't be any surprises.
No, there shouldn't be, but, you know, it's a good thing to have done, I'll say by October 1st, because a quarter of the year's already gone by. If I'm going off course somewhere, I really need to know
really
that.
Need to correct it, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think Chairman Halsey indicated, Dan, that maybe coordinate with him on some formatting. I know you've had some good formats in the past, or at least very good ways to bring everybody's material together.
Sure.
That can, you know, make it a little bit more cohesive to the draft heads.
You could certainly turn this into a quantitative measure, and there's a lot of things that, you know, all these things here, there's 11 things that are not, there's no room for them, but you could make room for them.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever else you may choose to evaluate the town manager on.
Yep.
To me, some of the more interesting things are in here, but we have no room because we've already, you know, by the nature, again, we're evaluating all our employees. For any manager, we've said first 11 and the last four are what you're evaluated on.
Right.
Middle don't count. Creativity could be one of the most important things in a job.
Mm-hmm.
We're not evaluating someone on that because there's no room in the form. And just so you know, these forms have to be negotiated with unions.
So they don't change very often?
No. And I'll give our unions credit. They've agreed to use them, and it's not always true in other communities.
Well, as long as there's a process for people to participate in it,
yep.
dispute it if they feel that mm-hmm. that you know there's disagreements, but also to and if there's, you know, serious cause, that at least if there's a written process and a paper trail. That's highlighted, thanks. So.
Yeah, and in this end, on occasion, you know, every couple of years, there's an employee who does not agree at all with the evaluation, and they make that quite clear in this part six. And at least in one case, refused assignment. He said, okay, you won't be doing that 2 years in a row, period. And so they didn't. But you have to be able to have a two-way feedback. There's no point in having one-directional feedback here.
Right.
I really like this format. The prior format with the numerics, I think the numerics actually got in the way. This is more language of affection rather than language. We're not going to do anything with the numbers. It's not like we're going to feed that into some
right.
other process.
It's not like a GPA.
They're right. pseudo numbers anyway, because they're really ordinal numbers that you're
yeah.
averaging.
Yeah.
And the averaging actually distorts the yeah. what you're trying to find, which is the outliers of both good and bad, right? So.
Yeah,
I actually like this. This is, in a fairly short number of pages, got all of the aspects that you'd want to look at, not just this role, but just about any role.
Very good.
All right. That being said,
last
you realize you're directly
Mr. Chairman, you are spot on here.
I do realize.
This is like Olympic record timing.
Within 10 seconds late, Kevin. Speed it
get
up.
Get every agenda. Right.
We have the approval of Amplified Sound Permit for Flag Football. That's something we've had over and over again in the past here.
Yeah, and upon a suggestion of
somebody.
John Feudo, which
look bad.
You may or may not agree with. Let me just find the motions. In addition to approving the amplified sound permit, I've given you the opportunity to delegate this to the rec committee if you want to.
I wanted to ask about that. What sort of variances and what scope are they going to be granted to give those variances? If you look at the motion,
you know, the this would only be for this one program, which has now run through 5 years, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you give me an example of what kind of?
I can't because I'm trying to imagine the things Carl been in front of us asking. I think he asked to add a speaker 1 year. He went up
yeah.
by one speaker, and if you remember, he's pointing speakers away from in the turf
right.
field, turf one, away from the tennis courts and out to the neighbors, in theory.
Mm-hmm.
So we did used to have one fellow that lived on the other side of Birch Meadow that did object. And he was, I don't know, he worked at MIT, I remember. So he and Carl had a lot of discussion about how much amplified sound was too much. So that the only example I could think of is when he asked for one more speaker. So, you know, if the board wants to do that, there's no real harm in being asked every year, but if you don't want to see this every year, you could make the recreation committee do it. And Kevin had asked me earlier, is there any example of this? And there really isn't. I can't. You've delegated certain things to other boards always and certain things to the town manager or his designee.
Get a one-day liquor license, right?
Yes. This came about, you know, for a very specific hot issue at the time.
Right.
Got discussed. It doesn't seem to be as hot an issue anymore, so it is something the board could consider, saying we don't need to own this every year, if you wish.
And then other than that one person, we haven't had any other complaints.
I'm not aware of them.
I think half the town is down there already playing.
The superintendent would tell me.
Yeah.
You know, the marching band, usually there's some complaints, especially when it's not the Reading marching band and they've rented out the field to a marching band.
They get there Saturday morning like 8:30.
Yep.
Yep.
And when they've rented it to college bands, they've been there right till 5, 6 at night. So from 8 in the morning to 6 at night, marching band center. But again, I don't usually get those complaints. The superintendent does. He hasn't mentioned them in 2 years. I think they may have cut back on their practice of renting those because they used to rent it to the bands that were coming in for the July 4th Wakefield parade, for instance. And I'd occasionally get a complaint. The police chief would get a complaint. We haven't got one for a couple of years. Of course, the Wakefield parade disappeared for 1 year. So that's really up to you.
And any authority that we have granted, we could always rescind as well.
Take it back. Yeah, if there's a problem, you just haul it back in.
The only history, the only reason I would hold on that is this is kind of where the arguments have always been at this level. And it's going to end up here anyway. So for the sake of disposing of the question here, it avoids having the rec committee having to fight over with, and I'm going to go to the Board of Selectmen anyway. Just call it here.
Yeah.
So you're not in favor of the variance, or you are?
I'm in
favor of moving it to the...
I'm not in favor of moving it to the rec, because I think you're just handing them a problem that they're going to be wrestling with, and it's going to end up in your lap anyway.
All right.
Well,
yeah.
I think we probably spent more time talking about...
But we've never had the problem.
Just do
now,
it.
How long have we had amplified sound?
4 years.
It's 4 years now?
For flag football.
I know the date well.
No, the bylaw.
Oh.
Don't know.
2011, I believe it started.
Yeah, I think it's 5 years.
Okay. And has it ever come before the Board of Selectmen?
Oh, yeah.
Flag football. I mean, has there ever been lively discussion?
Last year. No, it's never been an objection I've heard. There's been comments about, you know, keep it down or...
Okay.
Or I think there was some issue with directionality 1 year.
Yes, that was that fellow.
That was the fellow across. Yeah.
But he never came back after the season was over and said I was right. It was terrible. I couldn't live. You know. So...
He sold his house.
Yeah. I also think this is somewhat of an, I don't want to say accommodation, but to some extent it's a school. I mean, you're going to have kids are at schools a lot, right?
Yeah.
Thing, so.
Well, this is at night though, so that's the only difference.
Weekend.
Yeah, I mean, I really have no, I have no issues one way or the other. I have no problem with giving authority to to the rec committee, and, you know, because we could always rescind it, but I can certainly see your point where you also don't want to drop a problem in their lap that,
Now
they have to deal with rather than having us.
I think it might have been before you came, but there are a couple of instances where there was actually a dispute at the rec level, and it ended up here. And I'm just trying to avoid that group get into the swirl of the fight.
Yeah,
no,
I get that point. Yeah, keep it
as a convenience to them.
For them,
yeah,
for this.
It's not.
For
I don't doubt their motives or intent at all. It's simply that they can't control it. Then
right.
It's going to end up here anyway. Is there a motion on the floor?
Yeah, if you want to make the motion and just end it with the date, that would be fine.
Okay.
I'll support that.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the amplified sound permit for the flag football program from September 10th to October 29th, 2016.
Period.
Second.
Any discussion on that? Yes. Kyle.
One of the things that you have, or you said October 29th.
Correct.
If we have any rainouts, we just go to the following Saturday.
Okay, so amended October 29th or rainout dates as extended?
Just put like November 15th in there, why not?
Yeah.
Okay.
Friendly amendment accepted, November 15th.
November 15th. Anything else?
How many kids?
750.
Oh,
well, they can't.
Oh,
600.
Huh?
What?
Yeah. Maybe we have like 16 from out of town.
The band is
insatiable. The girls program is just exploding.
Did you say 753?
753?
And we have kids on our way.
What was last year's number?
683.
You're like growing at 20% a year.
Yeah. Wow.
And not to say anything, but if we had those extra lights.
All right.
Well, if we get the math right
next time. We just found 120 in debt that we could have used.
All right.
So, I mean, the program's great. It's really nice to see, like, the girls' division really, this year, we're able to actually field three divisions of just girls. And it's great because the mothers have started to coach the teams. And
oh, that's great.
They're worse than Belichick. I mean, they are ruthless in the meetings, which is good. And one of the new things we're able to do this year, Chili's is actually going to give every kid free dinner during the year. So
oh, that's great.
Bonds,
that's nice.
And the local businesses, we're trying to bring them in so that it's really a community event.
That's nice.
So it's going to be...
throwing moms and dads in there, you're dealing with thousands of people.
Yeah, no doubt.
2,500
we have. Yeah, that
pavilion. Because you get mom, dad, you get grandpa.
Grandma, grandpa, the kids,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
And, cool. You know, in the kindergarten division, when they start running the wrong way, some parents think it's cute. Some parents are like, oh my God, it's the end of the world. it's recreation. It's supposed to be fun. You know,
get them out, get them moving.
We just have, again, it's like a carnival atmosphere.
What was your takeaway last year in terms of the amplified sound portion of it? Did you get any complaints? Did you get any?
We never had anything. One of the things that we did before was we used to use the press box.
Yeah.
And those speakers are shooting towards Coolidge.
Right.
And Tennyson, Poets Corner area. And what we did was instead was
down
shoot
the field.
Back away from there, yeah. As well as the speakers that we had bought had like a distance where after like 200 feet,
it's top,
supposedly
yeah.
It's supposed to fade away. That's what they said when we bought them. We haven't had any issues. As I said, every year, you know, the police come down, we always go over what's wrong. They're like, we're just trying to figure out where everybody is.
we're trying to figure out where everybody is.
So they come down and...
we're bored.
The exciting part for Jimmy Murphy and myself is the fact that you're seeing people that could even be their next door neighbors, but they never see them. And they're down there for an hour, hour and a half talking, and then I know when I finish up at 8:30 and I'm headed down to Capri to get something to eat, and you go in there and
it's packed.
There's like 100 kids in there, or in their pizza world. So it's really nice to help the local businesses. When the meals tax, it helps you guys.
Still, that's
right.
That's right. Eat up.
So Bob always says.
That's a good win-win.
Eat up.
And then this past year, the Lions, the Reading Rotary Club, took over the concession stand, unbeknownst to us. They just showed up the first night, which was great. Giants did a really nice job. And John Darty, superintendent, pizza delivery guy, he really does it all. But, it's nice because I think it's extremely valuable for the superintendent that parents that normally don't have to interact with them can actually have a conversation with them. And I think he gets different feedback, which is good. But more importantly, they're really seeing, they're having conversations with him. And, you know, obviously with the override on the ballot, you know, it's a little PR. Also.
Yeah.
But
no,
being able
no
to
soup for you.
and the local businesses, as I said, are able to get some business out of it.
Cheeseburger.
That's great.
750
that's a great
kids.
Success,
Kyle. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Do you want to come out Saturday for the coin flip?
Unbelievable. What'd you start with year one?
200. The program's ground. We're in the additional towns and over. What we're looking to do, we have about 2,000 kids now, and in November is actually have everyone come in on a Saturday and just play each other, and that's really going to be a carnival. Absolutely, we've already worked with the bouncy house and all those types of things.
I was going to say, that's almost to sell off some space for your tents, $50 a pop, and bring your vendors on down.
Yeah, well, we just let them come. But you're more of a capitalist than I am. So, that's one of the things. You know, we're really going to try and make it, assuming the weather cooperates with us. We can't go too much further than like November.
Right.
It's just too cold. But again, it's another thing that we're trying to help the local businesses come in for those events too. From Cupcake City to there's a portable pizza vendor in town.
No kidding.
You can't even make a pizza in 5 minutes.
Wow.
That's great.
So it's been great. It's been a great partnership. I can't not, I was looking at this evaluation that Jenna employees. Jenna and not Mr. Fugue, except he'll take credit for it, but Jenna and Sue are great. Sue doesn't really like us right now because she's dealing with all the people calling in and stuff like that. But it's top notch, and I know it's on TV, but compared to other towns, recreation department, you guys have we really blow money.
Yep.
Some of the other towns I'm just like pulling my hair out.
That's great. That's good to hear.
I mean, they're on top of their game. Their IT system is outstanding.
That's great to hear. Thank you.
You know, one town actually didn't have an online registration system.
Oh, that must be brutal.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Okay. Yeah, Kevin, you had a comment?
Yeah, I've been a butter to the high school.
Okay.
At least for another 3 weeks. And I just got to answer John's question. I can hear the high school football games on Friday nights. Can't hear it at all.
Oh, okay.
So,
really?
You know, the people are there. There's a general, but in terms of hearing the amplified sound, you know,
I don't think I can.
I can't hear it at all.
You're not even aware that there's anything playing.
Right.
Yeah, with the amplified sound piece, I mean, you can see the light, you see the activity and all that. But in terms of the amplified sound piece, you can't hear it at all, so.
And one of the other things I just put in there, it's nice is we're starting to see a lot more middle school kids. And I always remember Chief Comier saying to us from the get-go, Friday and Saturday night, the most dangerous nights for the middle schoolers and high school.
Sure.
So keeping them busy until 8:30, 9 o'clock, roughly. We're usually done by 8:30, but as well as this year, I think we're hiring 42 high school kids.
Wow.
So, you know, we're again giving them jobs, and it's funny. I get so many calls from parents. Will you hire my son? I'm like, tell him to call me or her to call me. You know, make them learn those things.
Yeah, exactly.
Parents are. You know, you go to the Y and you come out with a couple of employees. It's a great thing.
Yeah.
So, but no, but I again, we have 42 high school kids that are working for us this fall, and they're going to be busy on Saturday night.
It's a great success story, Phil. It really is.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great job.
Wow, that is just amazing.
You gotta come down. You seem shocked. Come down. Or even, you can come to my house and help me separate all the uniforms. And you can say,
fantastic.
Thank
all right.
All right, we have a motion.
Do we have a second?
Do we have a second?
Yep, I second it.
Okay. All those in favor, as amended?
I'm going to the game on Friday.
4-0.
Football Friday.
All right, we have some minutes.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of August 9, 2016, as amended.
Second?
Second.
Okay. I have one comment on page 7. This is August 9th, right?
Oh, this is the
second paragraph. I think that motion is correct, but you need to soften it just a little because we did not technically adopt that factor by that vote. What I would do, Paula, is after the second sentence where it says senior tax relief, comma, add the words indicate their intention to.
Okay.
I think it was sort of more of a roadmap for a future board.
Yep.
Which paragraph?
Indicate
second
their intention
paragraph, first sentence.
To adopt a residential factor 1.02. So that really had no force of law.
Right.
That's a good catch, Dan.
Yeah, that's
thank
a good
you.
Catch. Problem with that.
Okay.
All right. All those in favor as amended?
4-0.
Very good and very thorough. Yeah.
All right, Dan, last one. You're on.
Sorry.
Pulling behind.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of August 16, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Any comments? All those in favor? 4-0.
Any new business?
Even the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10
o'clock exactly.
O'clock.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good night.
Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Need your signature.
Okay.
Oh, yes.